want to participate in a Don and Mike show contest? How about this? You or a member of your household can only win once for 60 days. You must comply with any age limitations for each contest. For complete contest rules, send a self-addressed stamp envelope to the mighty WJFK, P.O. Box 3649, Washington, D.C., 20007. Thank you, and God bless.
Oh, hold on. Didn't do it, did it?
Everybody loves Don and Mike.
Well, we're here.
And
hi, everybody.
The computer revolution that was promised is here.
Oh, good.
It's here. We've got all these new shiny screens.
That's cool.
Nothing works, though.
The future is now, gentlemen.
But it doesn't work?
Well, Mike, keep in mind that we've had...
Of course, none of this really affects me.
Keep in mind that we've had this on the drawing board since 1997.
1997.
To go digital. And they said that the 2 weeks that we were gone, they were going to totally revamp the studio.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We're going to be digital when we get back.
Yeah.
Get ready for touch screens. Get ready for all of the tapes on digital little press things.
My God, Wendell. When is the ever get anything finished?
You just drag a mouse across and click, and boom, there's the sound. And guess what?
What?
It don't work.
It doesn't work?
It don't work.
It's so easy for you to take a dim view, but look at what we've done. In 7 years and many man hours of labor, we have gone from 6 analog cart machines.
Yeah.
Now, Rob, no one knows what an analog cart machine is.
It's a tape player.
8 tracks. The 8-track tapes.
They look like 8-track machines. It's antiquated technology.
We've gone from 6 of them to 4 of them.
Well, there you go. Now, are you going to have to when this gets working, are you going to have to reach up to that little computer screen and press those buttons? Is that how you're going to do it?
Mm-hmm. No problem, Mike.
He's going to reach for you. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I'm going to have to get like a Dr. Ock thing.
A stick,
you know that Dr. Octopus thing where he's got all of the arms coming out of his back?
Exactly. Is that going to be your console now?
Well, Mike, again, here's what's funny about this.
Shouldn't it be down there?
Yeah, well, the whole thing, if it was me, I would have just blown this whole room up.
Uh-huh.
But it's not me, so you've got too much. But listen, it's a moot point because it doesn't work now.
So you can't press a button on that thing and get a sound?
Watch, I could press a button. Did you notice that?
The whole thing went pretty...
Maybe I pressed it a little too hard.
Yeah, you have to be gentle.
All right, let me see. All right, here we go. Nothing. It don't work.
When do they expect it to be working?
This week.
Oh!
This week. They've had 2 weeks that we weren't here, but now that we're back, the guy that installs the stuff, he's here. Oh, and here's even better news.
Right.
I have a meeting with Tony, the engineer.
Yes.
Before the show.
Bacardi Limon.
And he said what would really be helpful to the computer guys that are setting the system up.
Yes.
Is if they could spend a few days in the studio with us.
No!
Yeah, and that's what I said.
No.
That is exactly what I said. So, anyway, listen, we're back. Hold on.
Happy 4th of July, everyone.
Right, what the heck am I doing?
Congratulations to our nation.
We had, an intro tape that we didn't get to. Here's an intro tape today.
Hey, I like that. Some beautiful video from Tom Monroe from his latest disc entitled...
You know who it is yet?
No.
Jerry Todd.
Is it Jerry Todd?
It is.
Oh, fantastic.
Tom Monroe on a new wavelength, and that's a pretty thing called Turning Japanese. And a good morning to you. Welcome back to the Jerry Todd Show here in the wee small ones of a Saturday morning. We've got some fine video for you this morning, as well as another incredible contest cash call, and a lot more. And Jerry Todd will be right back in just a second.
I always watch the Jerry Todd Show.
Jerry Todd. And a good morning to you in the wee small ones of a Saturday. And we've got the request lines open on the Jerry Todd Show, and let's see who's there. Good morning. How you doing?
Hi, Jerry. I'm fine. You...
Pretty good. What can we do for you this morning?
Did you play Mission Impossible?
Which episode would you like to see, my dear?
I don't know any of them. Oh, could you play Stairway to Heaven too, Jerry?
Okay, we'll try and get that for you. Thank you for calling. Request lines are open anytime here on the Jerry Todd Show. And we're going to play the incredible contest in just a sec. Right now, though, some new video. This is from Five Easy Pieces. Take a look at this.
Jerry Todd.
Jerry Todd. A little chroma key for you.
You have to be a fan of SCTV.
Yeah.
And it was Rick Moranis' greatest bit. Mm-hmm.
Do you know I remember the one bad thing about SCTV?
What?
The bad...
Made in Canada?
No, the bad canned laughter. SCTV never knew how to put their canned laughter in. It would just be like this rolling laughter.
Jerry Todd.
Remember, those were the heads. Those were just like four or five heads that would be floating on the screen.
And that was Rick Moranis.
Yes, because Jerry Todd, Rick Moranis,
right,
was a video VJ.
Yes, one of the pioneers.
He would play videos, and when he had a
jingle. Was supposed to be on like a local TV station,
yeah,
right?
When he played a jingle, he played
Jerry Todd.
So anyway, having said that, hello.
Oh,
no. Hey. Hello. Oh,
he's back. Hello, Mr. Shannon.
I'm Jerry Todd.
Jerry Todd.
And I guess I'm Milford Drysdale.
What does a Mexican Eskimo eat?
What?
A burrito.
Oh, no. Oh, no, the guy's still sending us this stuff.
Yeah.
What disease?
Yeah, Buzz, I like your, yeah. We ought to isolate Buzz.
What are you
going to
do?
Hold on,
yeah.
There's one pretty good one, though.
Okay.
It's not this one. Hi.
Jerry Todd.
What disease, what disease do sheep get when they eat bad food?
What?
Botulism.
That's not the good one, is it?
No. This is the good one.
Oh, God, all right.
This is the good one. Oh, thank you, Robbie.
Jerry Todd.
What's Christopher Reeve's least favorite form of comedy?
What's that?
Stand-up.
The Don and Mike Show.
Hey, now.
Jerry Todd.
Hey, now.
There you go. Okay.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Right, we are, and there she is.
WJFK's Bill O'Reilly is brought to you by our content partner, AOL for Broadband.
He's not in here. Well, the computer just decided to work.
Wouldn't happen with digital.
Here we go.
True
story. He was a neo-Nazi with one true enemy. Himself. A man of faith. A man of hate. And his soul torn apart. Viewer discretion advised.
You know what's nice about my guys?
What, your guys? What about them?
They brought a balloon for Mike's birthday. It's a rigid air show. Good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. No disrespect to Orientals and all the ships at sea. Recently chosen as each other's presidential running mates.
Yes.
Don Geronimo and Mike Mara.
Thank you, Robbie.
Yeah.
Thank you. Hello. Give me a moment with a new configuration of the board.
Very good.
Don and Mike Show, a new episode on this Tuesday. 07/06/04.
Hi, Don and Mike. Buzz Burbank here.
Okay, that should be the toughest part. Playing all of those tapes at the beginning should be the toughest part.
Yeah, that's the part of the show where your fingers actually do the bleeding.
It is July 6, 20-04.
July!
You can call us from anywhere in America at 877-365-3636 from Canada. Call 800-636-1067.
I love me the July.
And on Washington, D.C.'s WJFK-FM.
Jerry Todd.
Call us at 202-432-1067.
Very good.
So hope everybody had a very safe and sane holiday.
Mm-hmm.
We're back, and I'm ready for it. I had a great vacation, but I'm ready for this.
You're ready to get back to work.
Yep.
Always are.
Well, no, not always.
Quite often you are.
Of the rare occasions when I've had such a fantastic time, and those rare occasions have been generally when there's not a lot of other people involved.
Mm-hmm.
And, I love it. And I'm not complaining about all the people that we had down this weekend and last weekend and all of the days in between.
You've got plenty of family?
It's a lot of people, and I've got a lot of stories, and my wife and I had some public moments, some public, not PDAs, not the
public displays of affection?
PDAs,
public displays of animosity?
Public displays of displeasure, PDDs.
Well, you could keep it PDAs. You could have public displays of animosity, public displays of aggression.
Anyway, all of that. Can't wait to tell you about
public displays of aversion.
All the stuff that happened over the weekend. We're not in our new office yet.
No.
And I'm very disappointed about that.
Jeff Hedges, though, the sales guy, He already has his office done.
He's moved into his office.
And as a matter of fact, there is a school of thought around here that thinks that the computer stuff in the studio is not done because for the last 2 weeks they've been busting their balls to make sure that Jeff Hedges gets his office upstairs done.
He's delighted. He loves his new office.
Man who gets things done.
And our
he's got a two-office suite.
Our office downstairs is coming along. Do you know that Beth Ann McBride spent most of last week? I'm so glad that we have a woman as a producer because she does all the woman jobs. she spent last week cleaning.
Cleaning, cooking.
She was cleaning,
preparing snacks for us.
Pies.
Cleaning the carpeting. And do you know this? You know that this dear, sweet maid, producer, actually painted the walls in the office.
That lovely baby blue?
Yeah, because we're doing a trading spaces. Thank
blue for boys, pink for girls.
We're trading with upstairs to come downstairs. So anyway, the office is not quite done, just like the computer stuff and the board. But as always, they promise it will be happening soon.
Well, I will select furniture for the... I will work with Bam to... as I have offered before, I will pop for the furniture in that studio.
And that's why you are...
Jerry Todd.
I am Jerry Todd.
Now, we also have... before we get to all the stuff that we did and all the stuff that we'll be doing, we do have, once and for all, a list of all the stations that are currently running the show.
Impossible.
No, Buzz, it's true. And your current total list is 44.
44 total.
44 stations. Now, there are new stations signing on in the next 2 weeks. But because it's infinity and because, you know, they're secretive about stuff, mm-hmm. we're not allowed to say what these markets are that we'll be coming into.
Okay, then.
However, there is one market of the four markets that we're going, at least four, that we're going to be entering in the next 2 weeks.
Uh-huh.
One market where we've been before.
Mm.
And we're going to be able to make that announcement today at 5:30.
So stay tuned for a major show announcement coming up at 5:30.
Well, you know, major for this show.
Jerry Todd.
I think this is big.
And the reason we can make this announcement...
I mean, it's not big, but it's big enough.
Nice for us.
We're going to make this announcement today because we're going to start tomorrow in this particular market.
Exactly.
So that's what's new. That's what's happening. I'll tell you that...
I was going to say something, but I'd give it away if I said it.
Right, so don't.
Jerry Todd.
And it's such a good line,
yeah.
too. I wish I could get away with it.
Well, you could, but you might just wait 2 hours. We'll talk about it 2 hours.
I know.
Because remember, radio is a cutthroat business.
Right.
What they're doing now, the reason that they've explained to me, we've got these clears for the show and some markets.
I don't think I give anything away.
We'd like to be in, but they have to fire disc jockeys to tell them they're going to be replaced by syndicated programs.
I'll just say this. If you have exotic dancers in your family, you might want to alert them.
Mike, I think everybody knows.
Okay. There's so many, Don, there's so many
Mike,
cities.
No, when you say that, you know what I think of. You know what every guy thinks of.
All right, but who knows? You know, who knows?
I don't know. You know who was a great guy, though? Venus de Milo.
See, if I'm bad, he's got to be worse.
I'll tell you what Venus de Milo's problem was. That dude could not hitchhike.
He couldn't.
No, it was a woman, actually.
All right, well.
Jerry Todd.
That'll be the new plate for any mistakes that are made.
Oh, really? What's that? What's that you say? It wasn't the Japanese that attacked Pearl Harbor. Oh,
Jerry Todd.
Well, anyway, it's awfully windy there.
Jerry Todd.
Could be any city.
Okay, enough about that.
Both the people.
So that's.
Well, their leaves.
That's happening. Oh, all right, buddy.
Jerry Todd.
That's for you. Anybody else?
No, we're done.
That is. You got anything, boy?
No, never do.
Jerry Todd.
We had a great vacation.
Yes.
I mean, speaking for myself and my family.
Oh, I know I did. Yes.
You guys did as well.
I certainly did.
My vacation, I just have to tell you, it started so bad and it had two gigantic fights. I mean, there's a bunch of great stuff.
Hadn't you had one with your wife right before the vacation anyway?
Yeah, and this is why she is just the queen of mean when she wants to be. It was the Friday before we were going to take our summer vacation.
Mm-hmm.
And she's already down in Ocean City at the beach. And there's a problem with the air conditioning that I guess A couple of weeks ago, the air conditioning had broken. I went down and looked, saw the sticker on the thing and called the guy, and they came out and they fixed the air conditioning.
Right.
So she gets down there a couple of weeks later, turns the air conditioning on, and nothing's happening. Now, she called during the show. She called during a commercial set. So she doesn't want to be on the show to be funny, to try to bust my chops, to try to have a conversation. She calls me seriously on the hotline during the last hour of the show, before vacation, you know, and no one wants to leave a show, a job, whatever it is. You don't want to leave with a bad taste in your mouth.
You don't want to leave angry.
Right, you want to leave happy. So, anyway, I pick up the phone, I go, hello, and she says, I'm quoting, it's just another thing you've effed up.
Ooh.
And I said,
ouch.
Huh?
That's nice.
Why? And she said, the air conditioning, it's broken. I gave you one simple job to do, and you can't. I said, wait. The guy came out. It was fixed. She said, well, it's not fixed now. And furthermore, you called the wrong guy. We have a service agreement with some other company. I said, I called the company that had the sticker on the air conditioning unit. So I ended up hanging up on her. We did the last break of the show on Friday, 2 weeks ago. I think I mentioned something like, oh, my wife's just pissed me off. I got in the car, and she calls me up in the car, and I said, how dare you call and yell at me about that? I said, I was really wrapped up in the,
dare you, Mr. President?
I was such a jerk face. I mean, she was a jerk too, but I laid the whole thing. I said, hey, baby, this is how I make our living. Mm-hmm. I'm in there trying to, and what you call and you yell at me, tell me it's another thing I have to, when I handled it, I mean, I lost it with her. I said, I handle things the best that I can. If you don't like it, you can just kiss my ass. And furthermore, I'm not coming up the beach tonight. I'm coming up tomorrow. Man, whatever you think about it, I don't really give two rat asses. You just get off the yeah. I mean, it was like that. And then I went home Friday night, and
you weren't going right down to the beach on Friday night.
Well, I was going to.
Oh, you were going. You changed your mind.
And I screamed at her. I said, "Now, because of this, I'm not coming down till Saturday because I'm mad at you."
Mm-hmm.
And you know, for me, these are big words coming out of my mouth because I never backtalk my wife like this. But she really had just pushed me to the point. So I got home Friday night. Found refuge where I always do, bottom of a bottle.
And in front of the magic box.
And I sat there thinking, you know, at any moment, she's going to call. At any moment, we just had this giant fight.
Yeah.
We're starting our vacation.
She'll want to make up.
Sure. So I sat there like a dope and looked at the phone till about 11 o'clock. And then I thought, she's not calling. Because she knows I'll call her. Because I always call her, even when I'm right, I always call.
Right.
So I thought, you know what, screw it.
Not this time.
I ain't calling. So went to bed on Friday night, got up early Saturday morning, not a word from her.
Mm-hmm.
Got in the car, drove to Ocean City, gave her a call on the way. It was a what did Larry King say? Just brief.
Just brief. A greeting, just brief.
Just brief. I called and I said, hi, how you doing? She said in that very measured, I'm mad at you, but I'm above it. She said, I'm fine. Where are you? I'm on my way up there. I'll be there a couple of hours. Okay, see you then. All right. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Oh, not good.
So I'm still steamed.
Goodbyes are code.
Yeah. I am still steamed. Now, a couple hours later, now Saturday morning, I arrive up at the beach, and lo and behold, as I'm there, the guy from the other air conditioning place is there.
Fixing it.
And, no, here, now, Mike, this is where it gets crazy.
Okay.
When the original people came out to fix the Freon leak, they did that. However, the guy from the second place, when I arrived, he was just walking around and looking at it. He said to me, you know, there's no problem with these air conditioners. There's no problem. The Freon leak was fixed. I said, well, my wife says they're not working. He said, well, have you noticed on the back, and, you know, we have two big air conditioner units in the backyard. He said, you see that button right there that says reset? And the letters R-E-S-E-T have to be 2 inches tall.
Mm-hmm.
They're like for a retard. You know, what's her name? Lindsay Lohan could look at this thing and go, okay, reset. So he says to me, this is the problem. The other guy didn't reset the system. All you do is just hit one button and everything's going to work perfectly.
And he said that to you?
Yeah. So I said, well, I appreciate it. That's good to know. Thank you. So I hit the reset buttons and you hear, the thing charges up, and I go inside, and now I'm ready to have it out with my wife, because I go upstairs and I go, hey, guess what? when the guy that I called to fix it came out here before, he fixed it. He just forgot to hit the reset button.
Oh.
And when you were out there looking at those units telling me you couldn't figure what was going on, You mean to tell me I brought around the backyard? I said, you couldn't see this sign right here?
Mm-hmm.
Reset? I said, it's on both units. Look at this.
Even though it's a sign that you would have walked right by.
Of course. of course.
Relevant.
But here's where it gets nutty. Because now she said, I don't want to even talk to you about this. I said, no, wait. I'm hot. I'm hot like I haven't been hot at you in years. I'm pissed. I said, you screwed up the end of the show yesterday. You don't call me last night. You leave me hanging. I drive up here all the way today. The guy tells us it's just a stupid button, and you won't let the freaking thing go. She says, no, I won't. And she gets on her bicycle. And she's got like one of those Wizard of Oz bikes, like Dorothy. It's got a little basket up front where she puts her dogs. Hold on a second. I see. I hit that button. So this is the music. She starts to ride away on her bike. And I do this thing where I run over in front of her. And I'm standing now in the middle of the road by where we live.
Oh, no.
And I am holding on to the bars in the front of the bicycle. And I'm standing and say,
restricting her movement.
She says, stop this. Let me go. Now, we're doing this in the middle of the street, in front of neighbors and everything. You know,
people starting to come out on their patios.
We've become the people that we mock when we go to the beach and look at the inbred rednecks fighting.
Right.
This is what we've become. I said, as I'm holding, now, it's almost a tug of war going on.
Yeah.
Because she's trying to pull the bicycle back, and I'm pulling. I said, you're not going anywhere. You're not running away this time. We're going to have it out. She says, I'm not going to have it out until you're calm. I said, I'm not going to be calm. I've been uptight since last night. And then I swear to Christ, at that moment, the air conditioner guy comes back around the block. I'm in the middle of the street arguing with my wife, pulling on the bike, and the guy, if he's listening out there from Ocean City, call in, because he'll tell you this is true, I swear to God. We're screaming and yelling. The guy pulls up and gets out of the car and comes over, and we are having a fight. I mean, you know, not a physical fight, but right. We're having a fight. And the guy walks right up, and he says, you know what? I thought so. He said, you Don? Don and Mike?
Perfect timing.
He said, hi, yeah, yes I am. He said, well, that must be Frida. He said, it is Frida. And then we realized we were having a screaming match in front of the house, and I'm pulling on the bike, and meanwhile, this guy just as nice as can be. And then the next thing he says is, you know what I like most about the show? When y'all call in and talk and about your lives, and boy, you've done a great job raising Bart. He's a good boy. And I'm looking at him like going, dude,
did you find yourself softening at this?
Didn't you just hear us screaming at each other? Yeah. And
yeah. But was he relaxing you by saying this?
Yes, he was. And the best thing was that while the guy was there, I was able to get my wife off the bicycle.
Oh.
And
by throwing her to the ground.
Yeah. Or, you
in
know,
front of him.
Or in the old days, I would have had another answer for that, for getting my wife off the bicycle. But either way, she did dismount, and
right.
Then she could not run unless she just physically wanted to run from me. And at this point, there were all kinds of neighbors and stuff watching.
Physically run or flee, as some people like to call it.
Yeah, that's right, flee the scene. Mm-hmm. So the guy says, well, you know, love the show, thank you very much. And he drives away, and I said to her, now look what we've become. I said, look at this. We're as bad.
So you're all of a sudden, you just have this calm that comes over you.
Reflective.
It's amazing what a fan can do.
You know what, it, Mike, it was not the money fan guy coming by.
Fan can make everything better.
But you know what?
That's what I always say.
Whether it was a fan or a non-fan, just
right.
Somebody who walked by, mm-hmm. What's great is he broke the moment. Mm-hmm. And what was more important for me was, and as it turns out, later in the vacation, I had a chance to tell my wife even more of what I think about her. But for about 12 hours... she really got it from me. I mean, like, she doesn't get it from me.
Right.
She was...
It was your turn.
Yeah.
In 12 hours starting when you arrived at the beach?
Oh, no, I mean, like, 12 hours on Friday night,
oh,
all the
okay,
way
right.
to when I got
okay.
to the beach on Saturday. And then, this is weird. You tell me, Dr. Freud, what you think about
okay.
this. I was chilling out later that day.
Tell me your dream, Bob.
I was chilling out. It was Saturday. We had had the fight. We kind of made out. you know, made up and made out. Yeah, baby.
She's still down next to the bicycle.
And, and she came upstairs, and she was mopey, little, you know, whim-whammy. And I said, hey, baby.
She was what?
Whim-whammy.
I've never heard that.
You never had the whim-whams?
I've never heard you use that before.
You never had the whim-whams before?
Whim-whammy?
Whim-wham is when you're just...
I mean, you're up and down, you're kind of so-so?
Yeah, you're whim-whammy.
Whim-whammy.
So she's got the flip-flops. She got the flip-flop.
I like the whim-whammy.
So I said, what's up? She said, nothing. I said, well, you're all whim-whammy. What are you whim-whammy about? She said, well, just those things that you were saying to me. She said, you said all those things to me, and I was just wondering, you know, gosh, you must have really... thought all of those things if you said those things. I mean, and this was the opportunity now for me to retreat, because at this point we were getting along fine, and I could have just said, nah, you know, honey, I was just mad. And but instead,
oh dear,
I just said,
oh no,
well, I just said what was on my mind. I guess it was a long time coming, but I just told you what was on my mind.
So you spit some real poison, and then you're backing up the poison? You know,
yeah.
That's against the rules?
And then she said to me, she said, well, you know, and this is where she's doing her psychology. She's, you know, I guess it's good that I hear this, that I know what my husband truly thinks. I'm glad that you finally decided to tell me about my many shortcomings and flaws, and I didn't know that you had felt this way. And this is the tragic mistake. I said, I've not felt this way forever. She said, oh, how long you felt this way? I said, oh, I don't know, just about the last month.
Oh, no.
And it was...
You didn't have the red light going, warning, warning, warning.
No.
Overheat, overheat, overheat.
It was just a dope, just a dope. So
did she storm out after that? Or
no, what? then you know, like, it really hurt her feelings.
Yeah.
And I've got to be honest, for about a day, I let her wallow in it.
Yeah.
I just kind of let her just wallow in the... I said to her, I said, now you know what it feels like in my shoes. I said to her, you tell me all the time what a loser I am. I said, what is your catchphrase for me? You effed up again.
Right.
And long after we were past this fight, at one point, my sister-in-law, Robin, and her kids, they were up, and Frida said to me, why don't you go down to that place, Fisher's Popcorn, and get us some popcorn? We want to watch a movie.
I love Ocean City. I love all the places.
All the trappings.
So I said, sure.
Fisher's Popcorn.
I said, I would be glad to go to Fisher's Popcorn.
Like, what makes Fisher's Popcorn better?
Who knows?
They're there.
Who knows? You know what makes anything great? Just that it's there, and it's oceany, and
right.
You have to leave the house to get it, and it's a big to-do, and, you know, it's the 4th of July weekend. It's like driving in Times Square to get to this 12 blocks to where this
right.
place is. You got to make 1,000 U-turns, and you have people with Pennsylvania plates honking at you. But still, I go up there, and I wait in the dumb line, and they got the size 375, 20...
Regular popcorn? Is it candy popcorn, or what?
Hold on a second. Now, the sign says, Fisher's Famous Popcorn.
Mm-hmm.
My wife sent me for popcorn. When Jeff Spicoli said to me, what would you like? I pointed at the $7.50 plastic container. I said, I'll take the $7.50 with popcorn. He said, all right. And then you have to go down, you know, 10 yards to another window where you pay, and then you go another 3 or 4 feet to another window where you actually pick the popcorn up. It's like an assembly line.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So I gave the guy the money, and the other guy gave me the big plastic container of popcorn. And I go home thinking, here's a simple job that I've done because I'm a good guy. So I get home. And
meanwhile, things are not exactly stable right now.
No, this, things were okay at this point.
But they're a little wobbly.
A little bit. And
I
come in, and I go, well, girls, here you go. As promised, your tub of Fisher's popcorn. And I'll give my wife credit. She says, oh, thank you. That's fantastic. Thank you very much. Then she opened up, and she goes, you effed up again.
She said that?
Yeah. Oh. And I said, now, hold on. What did I do? She said, it's caramel corn. I said, I told the guy popcorn, and she said, Fisher's is famous for selling caramel corn. Like, I'm supposed to know this. You're supposed to ask for popcorn. I said, the sign says Fisher's popcorn.
Yeah.
I told the guy popcorn. I made the trek in 4th of July traffic to get you the stuff. And you know what she said? She said, never mind. I'll go back and return it myself.
Polished. She didn't want the... Isn't caramel corn nice and gooey and yummy?
Yeah, well, it's great. You know, it goes against everything Frida stands for.
Oh, you mean like as far as the health nut
and
stuff?
It's not natural.
The sugar.
So she said, never mind, I'll just return it. And I said, well, like they're going to let you return it? I said, like, there's a place that sells yeah. food.
It's like it's a jacket that doesn't fit.
Hey, you're going to buy a big container of popcorn. Come back and go, hey, I got the wrong kind.
I stuck my hand in it.
Yeah, would you take
after
it?
I went to the bathroom.
And give me another one. And here's what killed me is that I told her, I said, you know, here's what gets me, is that I try to do stuff for you, and even when I try, you don't even begrudgingly give me the at least like you do to the dog, to say, oh, that's a good boy because you mm-hmm. went potty outside. I said, you could at least say to me, thanks for going, thanks for making the effort. She said, and furthermore, it took you way too long.
Ouch.
I said, it took me too long? You check out the traffic out there, honey. Everybody's going somewhere. She said, never mind. I'll do it myself.
Right.
So now
she really take it back to return it?
No, she did not return it, but she did
get another one.
Go up there and get, and she came back at about half the time that it took me. Mm. And she came walking through the door just as happy, you know, la sure. la 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 la. Oh, look what I got! It's regular popcorn.
Did anybody eat the caramel corn?
Yeah, the kids did.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Kids all ended up eating it.
I don't know why.
But it was
important to me, but it is.
It was just another one of those.
I gained 20 pounds on my vacation.
Ouch, really?
No, not 20,
oh,
Buzz.
No, I'm asking.
It's just another one of the many things over the holiday. And Buzz, I think you heard it, or rather Rob.
Yeah.
Rob and Carrie and the kids were up there, and Frida's so familiar with Rob that she started telling Rob things that he was effing up.
Yeah, it's always nice to spend a few days at Eggshell Castle. She's quite really? Forward.
So you get it too now, huh?
Oh, yeah. And Carrie's not really going to back me up.
Right.
Yeah.
No, so it was... oh, we got a break. I got so much. You know, there was an even better fight than that one.
Really?
The first one was...
The fight was... there were... I counted eight.
Oh, no, there was only two real fights. The only real
fight... The one with the bicycle and the one with the popcorn?
No, the one with the popcorn was just a sidebar.
Right.
Just another thing that my wife... And I brought this to her attention as well. I said, I wanted to tell you this for years. And I'm sorry, I'm going on here, but I've been 2 weeks without a bully pulpit.
You need your, this is your psychotherapy.
And I said to her, you know, you do this thing with your mouth. I said to my wife, are you aware of this? I've seen you do it with other people. If I was to say to her... If it was cloudy, and I was to say, I heard on the Weather Channel, it's going to get sunny later, she does her mouth like this. She does kind of the corner of her mouth goes down in a as if to say, you idiot.
See, now you're doing that. You're saying the corner of her mouth goes down, but the corner of your mouth goes up.
Well, that's because I'm smiling, Mike, because I'm happy to be here.
But I got it. It's a look of doubt.
Yeah, what
I mean, what you got to go...
Yeah, and she doesn't.
Like, I don't know.
It's not even all.
Is that
of
the
that.
Look? Is that the look? I don't know.
It's not all of that with the face. It's just your mouth. Mm-hmm. Like Mike, say to me something impossible, like the Red Sox are going to win the American League East.
The Red Sox are going to win the American League East.
Think so?
Oh.
So it's subtle. And I said to her, "You know what? I'm tired of you doing this thing with your mouth." And she said, "What thing with my mouth?" I said, "Darling, I've been telling you for 20 years. You do this thing. It's like you're giving me the finger." Whenever I say something that's not right, I said, it's your unspoken way. And, you know, damn the members of her family, and damn you and your family, Rob, for not being honest with her. When I would ask anybody else that had been around for the 2 days, when I would say, hey, we were sitting in a group of people and say, anybody else just see that? Frida just did that thing with her mouth. Everybody else says,
of course
I don't see what you're talking about.
Well, Rob's in kind of a win-win situation there, isn't he?
I don't see what you're talking
can't
about.
Can't lose there.
Yeah.
Rob just got to, first of all, you're a guest.
Right.
And you don't want to, you know, I mean, you know Don, you're tight with Don, but you don't want to upset the applicant. If I was Rob, I'd probably do the same thing.
Yeah, I know.
Well, but you didn't remember what I said. I said, do you have a pistol?
He did.
That's funny.
He did. And listen, don't get me wrong. I'm just getting this fight stuff out in the beginning.
Got to.
Then I'll get to there was plenty of fun stuff and fun with Rob's kids.
Yeah, that's no fun to listen to.
Fun with Mike's kids, or Rob's kids. I'm sorry. Who is it? Dan? Hello, Dan. Don and Mike show. Hello, Dan.
Hey, Don. What's up?
Hey, dude.
Hey, I met you. You were walking the dogs out there. I offered you free umbrella service. I got to say, I was a little offended. You turned me down.
You know, I'll say this. I really am the king of Ocean City, Maryland. I really, I can't go anywhere in Ocean City. I was out walking my dogs.
You could run for office down there.
I'm out walking my dogs. And this dude drives. I remember you.
Yeah, Green Sag. bad, and you got me.
Right, this dude drives by, and then he stops, and he backs the car up, and I'm just walking my dog. And he says, "Hey, Don, right?" I said, "Yeah."
Yep.
"How you doing?" He said, "You ever want a free umbrella rental out on the beach? I'll give it to you." And then I said, "Do you have an umbrella that I could stab through my wife's heart?" And he said, "Hey, it was nice to meet you."
Yes, you too. Enjoyed it much.
Okay, see you later.
Take care, brother.
Bye-bye.
Bye, brother.
Again, a fan brightens the day. There. He brightened my day.
He did.
Hey, I was a little offended, huh? You want a free umbrella? Or a free umbrella, like, to sit under in the sun?
He has a rental out on the beach where he rents...
Those are handy.
He rents chairs.
That's
and
probably big bucks. Isn't it?
Like $10 a day.
Yeah. I mean, he's got the whole concession down there.
Yeah, for his area of the beach. Hello, Matt. Don and Mike.
Hey, Don. How are you?
Hi.
Hey, Mike.
Hello.
Hello. Hey, Don. I gotta stick up for you on this one with the Fisher's popcorn deal.
Yeah.
That's the only thing they sell is caramel corn. She should have known that if she wanted the butter popcorn or whatever it was.
No, no butter. God forbid. Oh, that's the other thing. What
did she put on it?
Nothing. When we went to Spider-Man, she flipped out like this. She said, "Let's get a popcorn and share it." I said, "Fantastic." I said, "One large popcorn." She said, "No butter." No butter. I said, "No problem."
What's the point?
No problem. So sitting right up by where you get the straws and stuff is this little shaker that had like a cheddar cheese type salt.
Right.
Mm. So I just started sprinkling that on and she goes, Hey, what are you doing? I said, I'm putting something on the popcorn. And she looked, and again, I get the look of the mouth like, and she says, to the guy, the pimply guy behind the counter, "Oh, now we need another popcorn." You know, because God forbid that
she likes her popcorn naked.
Yes, she does. And I'm with her. I don't need it swimming in creamery butter.
But I like it like Homer Simpson likes.
Yeah.
Really. And if you don't tell those kids not to, they will give it to you like Homer Simpson. You know, they'll sit there. And I just sit there and look at them and I go, "All right, pump one. How many pumps you got?" 15. You rock, kid.
Remember when you used to attend the concession stand when we have our screenings?
Oh, yes, do I?
Be
yeah.
Puddles at the bottom.
You remember that?
Popcorn.
Yeah. You would actually have to. You could not put that popcorn on your lap because you'd have a stain.
No, the container would turn transparent by the second reel.
Anyway, listen. We got a break, but Matt, here was your point to me that I've been going to Ocean City since I was a kid. That I should have known that Fisher's is famous for selling caramel popcorn.
I'd sure like me some of that caramel corn.
Even though the sign just says Fisher's popcorn.
Really, all the flavors.
So you wanted,
they have all
so
sorts
she
of flavors?
Wanted caramel. She wanted the caramel?
No, she did not. She wanted plain.
And they gave you the caramel like they always do, right?
Yeah.
So I can't understand. Well, first of all, why would she want to pay $7.50 for, you know, a bucket of plain
because she's married to the world's most generous man.
It's Fisher's. What other flavors do they have besides caramel?
Blood. Huss.
Oh, God.
Essence of toe jam.
Do they have, like, chocolate?
No, really, they have steak. Ham.
Oh, come on. I'm into the popcorn.
Mike, I think they have cheese and regular and caramel.
Is it really that good?
I wouldn't know. I didn't eat any of them.
You didn't eat any of them?
Hello, Grant.
It's famous.
Hey, guys, what's up?
Hey.
Yeah, if she saves that big tub of popcorn, I believe she gets a refill next time you guys are down there, because I was there yesterday, and I have only those little 250 cups or bottles.
Say that big old bin. You'll be able to take it one over and get another bin full of popcorn.
Dude, let me ask you a question, though.
Uh-huh.
You go to Fisher's.
I had one.
You go to Fisher's. Do you know that
Fisher's.
Do you know that it's caramel? I mean, was I wrong to just say, "Give me popcorn," and they just gave me caramel? Should I have specifically said, "Give me popcorn that's not caramel"?
No, everybody, they always give you caramel. I mean, you're not going to wait in line for an hour almost just to get plain popcorn, you know?
They don't need to wait an hour. No, no, right. Popcorn here, can you?
Another guy telling me I'm dumb. All right, thank you.
Don't forget to save that bin, though.
Come on, now. You bring the bin back, you get all the brie corn you need.
All right, call it being English as if you buy a bin of chicken.
Got a break. When we come back, geez, what do I still have to tell you? My Father's Day fun fiasco. Time with Rob and his kids.
Good.
And my godson, his son, Robert, who is the craziest.
Mm-hmm.
Also, Rob Spiewak in an athletic endeavor.
Oh, my. It wouldn't be volleyball, would it?
No, it would not, Mike. It would not be. And our wives getting drunk at Secrets. Lots of fun. Big fight. Oh, and I cut my own hair on this vacation.
Yeah.
So, it was good. Thanks, Mike. Thanks very much.
It looks good, baby.
It looks good on me. So, got a lot to talk about.
Yeah.
And I know you went to a place with your kids.
I went up to a resort in the mountains with my kids and had a fantastic time. And then I came back and took a little trip to a resort for me.
You went to Atlantic City.
I did, baby.
You dog.
I thought it was fantastic.
You are a dog. Hold on. Gary. Boy, do I wish I was there with you. Gary.
Yes.
Yes. Hi, Gary.
Hi. How you doing?
Hi.
Is this Don?
No.
Jerry time.
What can we do for you?
I live down in Ocean City. Fisher's Popcorn is known for caramel. You do have to ask for the regular popcorn. It's a dollar off on that tub.
That is the land of the idiot.
Maybe they could just put a sign up for retards like me who don't understand the basic sign that says Fisher's Popcorn.
I agree with you. And my wife would have done the same thing.
Hey, sir, when you go to Fisher's, do you get to stand in the Mensa line?
I don't go to Fisher's. I can't even eat their popcorn.
All right, thank you.
Right away.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Got it. Thank you. Remember, our names are...
Jerry Time.
And we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Mom, Pebbles. You too, Dino. Dad is speaking on the radio.
The Don and Mike Show.
They are the Dean's Peanuts, Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
That's right, heard. Let's see. Oh, they're all alphabetical now. Bakersfield, California, KGEO. Baltimore, WXYV, Live 105. Buffalo, WBUF, 92.9. Burlington, Iowa, KCPS. Burlington, Vermont, 96.7, WXCQ. Burlington, Vermont, WEAV. Concord, New Hampshire, WXKL. Des Moines, KBGG. Green Bay, WNFL.
All right.
Let me see. What haven't we heard before? We've heard all of these before. The cities. Let me see. Besides those, Bakersfield, Baltimore, Buffalo, Burlington, Concord, Des Moines, Green Bay, Harrisonburg, Iowa City, Las Vegas, Madison, Ocean City, Olean. Is that how you pronounce that?
In Olean?
New York? I don't know.
Pittsburgh, Portland, both Portlands, Portland, Oregon, Portland, Maine.
Right.
Reno, Rochester, Sacramento, Salt Lake City, San Francisco, Spokane, Virginia Beach, Norfolk, Warren, Ohio, Washington, D.C., Wausau, Wisconsin, Wichita, Kansas, Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, Worcester, Mass., York, Pennsylvania, Johnston, Pennsylvania, Lafayette, Louisiana, Superior, Wisconsin, Portland, Oregon, I already told you that, Dallas, that's the middle of the night, Brownsville, Texas, Palm Springs, California, and then the new ones that start soon.
I didn't know we were out in Palm Springs.
That's the list.
We live in Palm Springs?
No.
Ah.
It's tape delay 4 p.m. to 8 p.m.
4 p.m. to 8 p.m., so it's right the drive. Okay.
Right, nice. Afternoon drive. And just, 90 minutes away from announcing where we'll be going back to tomorrow.
Jerry Todd.
Arr.
Yes, sirree.
Arr.
Jerry Todd.
Arr, mateys. See, I was doing...
I know what you were doing. Yeah, you know what's weird about that?
What?
Is we both have the same mindset, because I was kind of thinking about it, how I couldn't say anything.
That's right.
You know. You devil. But you are a ray of sunshine.
God, I'm trying to think.
Nah, don't bother.
Yeah, well, hold on.
No, once you come up with something, it'll hit you like lightning.
That's, I couldn't remember the name.
Mike, don't buck the system. Oh, God. Oh, my, oh, my.
Okay, so that's what's happening with our radio show. We're very happy. We're very happy that you're listening. Now, let me tell you about Father's Day. The first day back from vacation, we all just pile in stuff that happened to us. And I'm sorry, I'm a big mouth. I'm the lead voice. I'm Jerry Todd.
Jerry Todd.
So I go first. I have to tell you about my Father's Day fiasco, which ended up being fun.
It was a fiasco, though?
Well, it started off to be a fiasco,
mm-hmm.
because my son, let's see. Oh, God, he's all over the place, too. He's 19. He's got a job. He's doing great. But on the other hand, he's 19. He's got a job, so he's kind of independent now.
Right.
And he has figured out that if he works 3 or 4 days in a row, works 10 or 12 hours a day, he makes enough money for the week and can take the rest of the week off. He wanted to take a road trip somewhere, Myrtle Beach, somewhere where he has friends. He goes to college down in South Carolina. So I said, sure, go ahead. You know, whatever. Originally he said, Dad, here's the deal. I'm not going to be able to see you on Father's Day because I'm going to work that day.
I think you talked about that before we broke.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mentioned
that he was going to, you know, he was on it, right? He was aware of it and he made you, that was right before, that was the weekend we left.
Yeah. And so I was happy because he said, Dad, I'm not going to be able to make it for Father's Day, but don't worry about it because I'm going to be working. And I said, listen, you know, I'm glad you're working, you know, go kick ass. So anyway, Father's Day was a Sunday. Saturday, he calls me up and he says, hey, Dad, I said, what's happening? How come you're not at work? It was like at 11 o'clock in the morning. He said, oh, as it turns out, I don't have to work this weekend. I said, oh, okay. He said, and tomorrow, which in this case was Father's Day, he said, I'm going to be going to King's Dominion, big amusement park.
Mm-hmm.
He said, and I'm going with one of his friends.
All right.
Because he's taking his dad up for Father's Day.
To King's Dominion?
King's Dominion. What? Now, I sat there. Yeah, I know, Rob.
What,
I know.
What dad doesn't want to go to King's Dominion?
I know, but still, understand me, you know, Mr. Insecure, right, having gone through all this with Frida and my own inner demons in my head, I'm sitting there going,
did you want to be invited?
No, I didn't want to be invited. Here's what I didn't want. If my kid wants to, well, first off, he got a pass because he was going to be working.
Right.
So now that's changed. He's not working. Now, to put salt in the wound, he's going to go to an amusement park with a kid.
And another dad.
Kid and another dad. So, like, I've got the picture in my mind of them walking around and the other mm-hmm. dad, who's a great guy. I know him. He's a friend of mine. But I picture him.
I love you, son.
Right. I picture him.
Yeah. I know what you're picturing. I do the same thing.
He's walking up to the thing where you throw the baseball at the milk can.
Right.
And he goes, Bart, you want me to win you one of those SpongeBob things that he's too old for? But still, you know, I imagine him throwing.
I'm going to win that for you, Bart, since your dad can't be here.
That's my boy.
That's right. So I hung up the phone with him, and Frida said, what's wrong? And I said, nothing. He's 19. I don't care about it. And she said, well, no, he's probably so dense, he probably doesn't even really realize that he hurt your feelings, that you told him he had a free pass on it. I said, yeah, I told him he had a free pass when he was working, and
I think you're giving him a too free a pass if they say that. Of course he knows he's hurt your feelings. He's 19. You're old enough to know you're hurting somebody's feelings.
So I call him back, and I say, hey, I just want to let you know that, you know, whatever you do is okay, but I think it's pretty crappy on Father's Day that you're going to go be with your friend's dad just because you want to go to the amusement park.
Right.
He said, well, no, Dad, there's more to it than that. And I said, I don't even care. And he said, well, I'm getting in my car right now and coming down there. He's about 3 hours away. And I know he was waiting for me to say, don't do it. Instead, I said, great, see you when you get here. Hung up the phone and thought, all right, now this is going to turn out. This is
How long before he called you back?
Less than 2 minutes.
Oh,
less than 2 minutes. But then he did come on down to the beach.
Oh, good.
And then this is where it became a fiasco on my part. Because I had gone all, like a woman, I was all emotional about this. I got him to come up there for Father's Day, and Frida had made it a very nice Father's Day for me.
Right.
He got me a nice card, and we had a nice breakfast together, and the boy finally comes up, and he, where are we going to go? I said, we're going to go to my favorite place in Ocean City, Tequila Mockingbird.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great Mexican restaurant, kind of a hole-in-the-wall place, but really fantastic.
Right.
So we get over there, it's the three of us, and we're having a great time, and Frida said, oh, you know, we should order for Daddy. We should order Daddy the fishbowl margarita. And I said, I don't want the fishbowl. And then we saw someone bring one by to another unsuspecting dad.
Certainly, I can certainly imagine what it is from what it sounds like.
Well, and Mike, do you remember when you would go to Farrell's Ice Cream when you were a kid?
Yeah, you get the big giant bowl.
Somebody had a sundae. They would, like, bring it out. They'd have a cot.
Mm-hmm.
They would actually bring it. Yeah. Ding, 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 ding,
right.
Ding. Well, they know that this is going to be embarrassing to me. So with the waiter come, and incidentally, not only is it a 48-ounce actual goldfish bowl, the fish bowl, they put gummy worms in it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and when they come over, they, you know...
How do they taste with the tequila?
They make it... Well, I'll get to that in a second. They make a big deal about it, and as we were looking at the menu, Bart said, Dad, you realize that you could order anything in this. You could order the, you know, the thing that's got burritos and tacos and
right.
rice. Everything. This drink was the most expensive item on the menu.
I would think so, 48 ounces of booze.
So, they bring it over... And it's, of course, a production, and they got, like, little sparklers going, and it's like, see, Mr. Father's Day, we're giving you the big treat. So they sit this thing down in front of me, and everybody's looking at me, and...
That's when they told you the big news.
Which was...
You had to chug it.
Well, you would be happy, Mike, that I started drinking it out of the straw, and then at one point, to make my boy laugh, he said, Dad, drink it like Jethro. So I said, all right. I picked up the fishbowl and just put it up to my mouth.
It sure tastes good, Granny.
Took a chug, and we had a wonderful dinner, the three of us. The food there is great. Tequila Mockingbird's a great place. We paid the bill. We got up. As soon as we walked out the door of the restaurant, we'd been in there 90 minutes. As soon as we walked out, I said, I am so drunk, you are not going to believe this. And my exact quote to Frida was, I want to sleep, home go. That was what I said to her. I want to sleep, home go.
I was thinking maybe your entire, fishbowl margarita was going to come up on you or something.
Oh, no, I was, but it's like as soon as we walked out of the place.
Right, it hit you, the air hit you.
I was loving life, so we piled in the car, and they took me home, and she said, really, you weren't acting drunk during dinner. I said, baby, I don't know what it is. It was just like when we walked out of the restaurant. I went upstairs, and this is why the Father's Day was a fiasco. We went out to eat at about 4:45.
Okay.
We got back home at 6:30.
Mm-hmm.
I went upstairs. 2.5 hours. I'm sleeping.
So you went at 4:45 to, you had kind of the early afternoon meal.
Yeah, and because it was Father's Day and it was the only time we could get a reservation. So we had been there, you know, it took about 15 minutes to get seated. We'd been there maybe 90 minutes. We left and that's it. So after all this yelling and screaming, my son saying, come on, you got to come down, you got to do this. Here I am.
Daddy passes out.
World's greatest father. World's greatest father.
Did he split by the time you had awakened?
No, he came up at one point when I was sleeping. And it was the night that Clinton was on 60 Minutes.
Right.
So I was like half awake, but still that drunk awake.
Sure.
But just watching Clinton and not really remembering what was going on. He came upstairs and he said, hey, Dad, how you doing? And the guy said, I'm fine. So that was a hell of a fishbowl. Yeah, it was. Said, do you want to play putt-putt? I said, no, I don't want to play putt-putt.
What do you think this is, King's Dominion?
I don't want to play. No, he was trying to be. We had talked before I realized that the fishbowl margarita had hit me like a hammer. Oh, excuse me.
Uh-oh.
Before I realized that, I had said, you know, it would be fun because I was that goofy, loopy way.
WJFK.
The reset button. For goodness sakes. I got to learn where all the new buttons are now. And where's the click-click thing?
Yeah.
Right there. Come on. Come on. I didn't mean to say it. You got to cut me a slack burger with cheese.
Click-click-click.
There you go. Learning new buttons on the...
That's the alarm for the mallet.
So anyway, very long story short is that he came in and was smelling my boozy breath.
Were you happy that he came and joined you?
I was ecstatic. We had a great time. And then I said to him, you know, you're off the hook. Get out of here. Go back and be with the people you really want. Go back.
You really care about.
Go back and be with your friends. But it was
But it meant a lot to you for him to come up there.
Oh, it did. And obviously I had a great time, beyond a great time. And then, of course, you get this when you're leaving. Yeah. Do you want to take home the fishbowl as a souvenir? And I said, no, absolutely not.
But this is when you're leaving the restaurant?
And Frida said, oh, no, of course we want it.
So do you still have it?
Oh, we do. She on a wall where it sits in prominence.
That's wonderful.
At our home where now everyone...
Some nice glassware.
Everyone will be reminded.
Right there is probably the reason the drink costs also as much as it does.
Sure. Just a plastic fishbowl, though.
Oh, it's plastic.
Plastic, but high-quality plastic.
And what became of the gummy worms?
Oh, they got eaten, Buzz.
Good.
They got eaten.
Good.
I think it was in during my final swig.
Yeah, that's when I do it.
When I was much more into just drinking it right out of, like Jethro would, right? Bart said something like, Dad, there's just a little bit left. And I went, glug, 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 glug.
That's all the alcohol there.
And
glug, glug, glug.
It was the gummy worms. Anyway, it was a very, very nice Father's Day.
Good.
And I woke up,
At nine.
At about nine, I came downstairs. I felt great when I woke up.
Sure. Did you really feel good?
Yeah, I felt
normally
fine.
When you have that early pass out, it's just like, yeah.
No, I came downstairs, I said.
You take your wife out to the popcorn place?
Came down, said, hey, what's happening? And she's just sitting there watching TV. She said, well, I hope you got the Father's Day you wanted.
Yeah, right.
I said, well, I feel great. Where'd Bart go? Oh, don't you remember? You told him about an hour and a half ago when you were having the bag upstairs. He told him he could go on home.
Well, you had your dinner, that's all.
Yeah, and that's all I wanted. Mm-hmm. So that
you, I think you just want a little togetherness.
Yeah, and
even though it's not the national holiday that Mother's Day is.
No, it certainly is not.
Right.
And I did put a Mother's Day like tantrum on to get him up there, but anyway, the fishbowl. Remember the fishbowl.
All right.
So now we're done with that, and now Rob and Carrie and Robert and Julia are going to come up and spend a couple of days with
right.
us. And this is an entirely new dimension now because we've not had little kids in our, you know, Bart's 19. We've not had little kids. Julia's 4, Robert's almost 2.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert is to the age where he's into everything.
Right.
Which, and I told Rob when they came over, you know, they were apprehensive about coming over with their little kids because little kids tear up a house.
Yes.
He said, don't worry about it. We know that little kids tear up a house. Come on over.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert didn't really tear anything up. There was a couple of times that he walked around with very heavy crystal-like ashtrays that I was afraid he was either going to
smash his head or his
foot into.
But he, you have to admit, he's very dedicated to being busy.
Oh, he...
it's hard to relax with him around.
Now, mm-hmm. here's the...
Well, that's the age, too.
Yeah. Here's the first thing. If I didn't know Rob as well as I would, as well as I know Rob, I might think, if I was an outside observer, if you didn't know Rob's personality, you didn't mind, you might think that I snuck in and fathered the child.
Right.
And here's why. They bring Robert into the house, and what a boy. Is this my godson or not?
Right.
The first thing he says, he comes to the house, he points, TV! TV!
Yeah.
First words out of his mouth,
yeah.
And then when the door...
Well, he might get that from him, too.
Yeah. That's what I said, I know
yeah,
that
yeah.
from him, but if you didn't know...
Because that's both of you.
If you didn't know, but then when the doors wouldn't open, because the TV's in an armoire,
right.
Then he said, DVD! DVD. And I said, Robert, I don't know where the DVD is. And then he said, Toy Toy 2.
Toy Toy 2.
Toy Toy 2. That's Toy Story 2. That is the movie that Robert watches like
he's
mental
got good
patients.
Taste. That's
and
a great, that's
if,
a great
and if he's not saying Toy Toy 2 to get it on, he'll say it until we put it on, and then he'll go to everyone in the room in a circle and point and say, Toy Toy 2.
Does he want someone to watch it with
him? Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
Well, but now here's the thing. He wants someone to, he's like all little kids.
Mm-hmm.
He wants you to watch it with him until 5 seconds later when something right. else catches his eye.
Right. And then he moves on to yeah. the next subject.
Julia was the same way with Rosemary's Baby.
And Robert does this thing that really cracked me up. When he gets excited, like when he's happy, when we were down at the ocean.
Right.
When he was, the first couple of days when he was really exploring the ocean.
Does he go, fishbowl margarita?
No. Rob told me he does this all the time. You know how when Homer Simpson gets excited,
right.
his hands go out like this, and it's almost a W.C. Fields move with his fingers like he's ready to feel something up.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, yes, sirree.
When Robert gets very excited, like when he sees TV or when he saw the ocean,
right?
He ran down by the ocean, and he's got little Homer Simpson hands. And
the hands are going?
Yeah, and every once in a while, he'd pick up sand with one hand, and then he would remember that he was happy, so he had the sand in one hand, and with the other hand, he'd be doing the Homer thing.
Right.
He's standing there by himself. And Rob found the best way to babysit his kid at the ocean.
Right.
I don't recommend this for all parents. You have to watch the parents very carefully.
Right.
Rob dug a hole. Dug a hole.
I did.
Put
good
Robert,
size hole.
Right.
Put Robert in the hole, and Robert was happy for 2 hours.
Wow.
Yeah, because it was down close to the water, not so that the water was touching him, but you know when
right.
you dig down, near the water line to
sure.
hit water.
Yeah, of course, reinforce the sides.
No, you don't, because what he does...
It's just a joke.
He loves
I'm thinking about men that are, you know, in those ditches that, the, you know, when they... you didn't put any, like, planking up on the side, did you?
No, that was me.
No, although I did tell Rob at one point, after we were done for the day, and Rob was commenting how good Robert was sitting in his hole... He said, I think I had read something like last summer that there was some kid that died in a hole.
Because the ocean came in and it collapsed?
Yeah.
That's one of the risks you take.
Yeah.
Yeah, but at least we didn't have to pay for a babysitter. So, it's pluses and minuses.
It's the trade-off. You take the risk.
You
that's
make
right.
a T-chart. And
it's
that's
kind of a financial risk.
It is.
Hold on. Before I talk about we have to break. Before I talk about everything else, your kid's on the boardwalk. You on the boardwalk, you animal. The fight I had with my wife. Here's Rob.
Right.
We've been together now on this vacation. Rob and his family came up a couple of different times.
Right.
And we're obviously very familiar with each other.
Mm-hmm.
Not the first time our families have vacationed together.
Right.
We've been out on the beach for 5 hours. All of us wearing our bathing suits. Rob and I, you know, beautifully chiseled bodies. Mm-hmm. No shirts.
Chiseled bronzed bodies.
Anyway, we come back home, and they're downstairs getting their kids cleaned up, and I'm bringing down a load of laundry. And I'm getting ready to get in the shower, and I had a robe on. A robe.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And it was tied, and Rob, as I'm coming down the stairs...
Isn't that the way you dress around the house normally?
Pretty entertained.
Yeah, Rob says, I'm coming down the stairs, he goes, hey, he doesn't even... It's like, it's a passing thought. He just looks up in the paper and goes, hey, what's happening, Hef? And it's not, I said to him, I think I stopped you. Didn't I stop you? We just spent. What do you want me? I just spent all day seeing me out there in a goddamn bathing suit.
Right
now, because I've got this.
Well, what you should do, even though because Rob, you're familiar with him, but he is company, you should do what you always do, which is, of course, walk around the house naked.
Yeah, well,
totally
I
new.
I said hello, Hef. Then he. Accidentally.
It accidentally opened.
Okay, I don't want to hear about that.
No, that
thank you.
And then the running began.
And then both of you in the laundry room. That's no spin cycle.
That did not,
that's right.
That did not happen. All right, hold on a second. I'll wind this up. When we come back, Rob is athletic. Rob's kids, I love them. They're out of their minds. Why my dogs are out of their minds. Why my wife may have a new lesbian lover, Buzz. Sorry,
oh, no.
And it may not be your wife.
Oh, my God.
And also, the worst name that I found that I could call my wife. The worst name.
Ooh. Well, we all
worst,
know what that
no,
is.
No.
Worse than that.
Not that one.
Really?
I found one that's even better.
Wow. Do you get punished for it?
Yeah, oh yeah, I get punished for it big time.
Oh, all right, then it counts.
I get punished big time. She hates it. She hates it.
We can say it on the air?
Sure we can.
Bonus party.
Sure we can. The word is snob.
Oh, yes.
Snob.
Yeah.
And then she didn't like it because all evening long I continued whenever she would say something, I'd say, well, Frida feels that way because my wife, Frida, you see, is a... snob.
Yeah.
She did not take to that. Mm. That was part two of our argument.
Yeah. That was, if they ask you if you've used the word snob in a deposition, it's not going to be a big deal.
Shut up. Wow, somebody's feeling their oats today. Somebody.
Cherry time.
Hi, everybody.
Somebody's really feeling that. Now, if I said that, you would give me the sign like,
Don't you think the statute
of limitations?
Yeah, don't you think?
Yeah, but don't you think we probably shouldn't talk about that on the radio either way?
In a way, I really wasn't.
Don't you think, Jerry?
Cherry time.
Yeah, it's just a roundabout way. No, I haven't. I am feeling my oats.
You sure
I
are.
I guess I am. But, you know, you're always very excited to be back.
I am.
Know, and maybe I am, too.
Yeah, you are.
I'm just in that good kind of mode, you know.
Sure are.
And I love this. You know, I get to hear about these things and just hunt and peck and have a good time,
yeah,
man. I truly love it.
Someday when Mike and I write our book, you will understand.
Yeah, you'll understand what I was talking. That was a private show for Don. I apologize to all our listeners that might not have a...
And then perhaps you'll also understand the true bond that Mike and I have.
Yes.
Which can never be broken.
Absolutely.
Can never be broken.
Yes. The bond that, that ties each other across the sea.
Cherry time.
God! You're the worst!
I know.
You're the worst! You're doing a show for... Let me just thank you. Rob, do you know what he's talking about?
I did it first.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think? Well, never mind. I can't ask. Buzz, do you know what he's talking about?
Vaguely, but not specifically.
Do you think anybody listening knows what you're talking about?
I don't think so.
You know what, though? I don't care.
I know you don't.
I know.
Every time.
Haven't we been at it long enough?
Yes, we have. All I know is that Mike's being a bad boy today.
I know. I know. But you know, it all started with the new market. That's what got me going.
Yeah.
You know what it's like? You know, really,
I think things about that. Don't be such a tampon.
Jerry Todd.
Well, there you have it.
Yeah, well, what? They got an hour to do whatever they're going to do down there anyway.
God, we're terrible. Yeah. You know, really, don't tell us to do anything. Tell us to do something. You know, really, that's what our job is, though. Our job is you tell us to do something. We're not supposed to do it.
Right.
That's why we're lovable.
That's right.
We call it a Pennyman.
Oh.
We've given out some hints.
What's he doing today?
Poor old Alan.
Hello?
Where the hell's he? I don't know, but I saw him in the hallway. It's just not the same.
Hello, this is Alan.
What's not the same?
Greeting him.
Why?
I don't feel like... are we leaving a message for him?
Please leave your name, number...
I don't feel like I've been away from him for 2 seconds when I see him.
Thank you, and have a nice day.
Why don't you leave that as
a message at the tone? When you're finished, hang up or stay on the line for further options.
Yeah.
Hey, Alan, general manager, it's Don and Mike. We're coming dangerously close to talking about what we said we wouldn't talk about, but it really doesn't matter. Anyway, Mike had something he wanted to say to you.
Alan, what's great is when I go away for, 2 weeks and I come back and I see you, it's like we haven't been apart for even 2 minutes.
Jerry time.
Happy 4th of July. Bye now.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
From what was once an inarticulate mass of lifeless tissues, may I now present a cultured, sophisticated man about town. Hit it!
Aha!
If you're blue and you don't know where to go to, why don't you go where fashion sits?
Ha ha.
Different types who wear a day coat, pants with stripes or cutaway coat, perfect fits.
Ha ha.
Dressed up like a $1 million trooper.
What's up, guys?
Trying mighty hard to look like Gary Cooper.
Cooper, Cooper!
Yep.
Come, let's mix where Rockefellers walk with sticks or Rumbarellas in their midst.
Okay, so here we go.
The Don and Mike Show.
That thing already went. You can call. What machine is that on? Number 4?
Anytime.
There you go.
From anywhere in America. Okay. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Silly dilly dokio. I'm an idiot.
Yeah, that's true. You see, I've been using... What's up, guys?
The number one radio show in Haiti.
Yeah.
The Don and Mike Show.
I'm trying to work on some new controls today.
Yeah.
Bear with me. After all, I am...
Jerry Todd.
You're Jerry Todd. Yes, you are.
Okay, so you heard the thing with the phone numbers. You can call. We'll do a phone scan later.
Stop playing the Tom Gavin tapes because it's making me hurt. I'm beginning to hurt. What's up, guys? Because it's been very much on my mind after the 4th of July
it's
weekend.
10 games now.
Mm. Yeah. No, it's not. It's 8 games.
Well, you added on 2.
Yeah.
So that makes 10.
Yeah.
It's a 10-game lead the Yankees have now over the Red Sox.
Yeah, I had the worst, next to the postseason, I had the worst weekend of baseball that I could ever imagine.
What's up, guys?
It felt just as bad. Nice to know they can do that in the middle of the season.
Just remind you that every year Mike and I have some kind of baseball bet. He bets on the Red Sox.
I was waiting to get a call from you. I was waiting to get one of those calls from you when you saw it, like, on SportsCenter or something. I had one of those that you would have loved it. You would have loved me. When I just was miserable to be around, and I was at the restaurant, and no one wanted to talk to me, and it was just terrible.
Look around, Cafe.
And it was just not, it just sucked.
We made our annual bet.
They took 3 games.
Mike came in with the terms. He said that the Red Sox will win the American League East by 2 games, or the loser has to give Tom Gavin.
And that's Tom.
What's up, guys?
Right. A full body massage. Tom is nude with a towel on, but you have to massage every inch of his body, including his feet.
And even though it's not even the All-Star break yet, this is a very, very difficult task already. They're already talking about, you know, just hanging in there to see if they can make the wild card. And but it's not so far that I'm willing to concede just yet. But an early concession is possible.
You know who I
think, with the way they're doing now.
You know who I think is the real track in that division? Tampa.
Cherry time.
You know you're right though.
I know.
With Sweet Lou.
Just
Sweet Lou. But you know what's killing me? It's just they figured out ways to lose games, including going into the extra innings where they took the lead. And I said, hey, this is it. They're going to do this. And then the Yankees just do it to us. It's just. And, you know, I'm beyond going to the well where I'm going to get on the chat sites or talk to friends and say, hey, I'm never going to root for him again. Although maybe that might have come out of my mouth. I'm back with him again.
But once you touch Tom's sweaty feet, once you have to massage his arms.
I want a bucket of water in here.
His buttocks.
For right. What? I will do to dip my hands in.
To wash.
You know, and how long? Did we ever discuss those terms?
I believe it was a full show massage. Just a break. Just a break. You know, 15 or 20 minutes.
Right. Thank you.
Give an oil or lotion preference, or
yeah.
I'm not sure. Let me get that all figured out. Okay. I want something obviously minty, menthol-y. You know.
75. Ever since it went out. Okay. Game 7 and learned what it was all about.
That really, you know what?
Red Sox Nation.
That ruined my vacation. I mean, no, I had a great vacation anyway, but you know what? That was the low point because I was just so into it, so totally into it, and God.
Well, I wasn't even going to start it until after the All-Star game.
Well, this team is the opposite of last year's team. Last year's team was fun, fun, fun. This team is just how can we figure out ways to screw up and make our fans hate us.
Fun, fun, fun for me.
I mean, the fans, they're really doing a number on the fans. They are this team, this overrated team,
but Mike,
is making the fans hate them.
But not every fan has bet.
Because there aren't many fans as good as me.
They'll give Tom Gavin a full-body massage.
There aren't many fans that are as good as me.
That's true.
And I'm not going to give up on him. I'm not going to give up.
Good for you.
I think once your digits touch his glutes, the curse will be broken.
Do you think that if I concede the bet that the Red Sox will get the wild card
and go on to postseason?
Maybe next year.
I think when you're giving Tom the massage, I think the real way to get rid of the curse of the Bambino would be a nice happy ending.
God, that is beyond disgusting.
Knock on wood.
That is beyond disgusting. I am so bummed.
Can you imagine, Tom, if that happened? He's rolling around like a fish out of water.
You know, I'm going up there. I'm going up to Beantown. On the weekend of the 24th of July to see, I didn't really believe that they would be possibly in a position where they're going to be double digits out of first place.
Mm.
And it's going to, you know, I went up there just to enjoy the rivalry, and this team this year is not even allowing that to happen at the midpoint of the season.
I hope the happy ending isn't inadvertent.
What is the deal about the front, anyway? Is the deal about the front? Have we discussed the front?
Let's wait till after the All-Star break. Because, you know, the happy ending could happen when you touch his feet.
The happy ending could happen when I say, hi, Tom, slip out of that robe.
Here we go. American League, New York, 51-29. Boston 43-37, 8 games behind, and then you add in the 2-game cushion.
That's
you gave
10
yourself,
games. You're absolutely right.
That's 10 games, and that means that...
And the Red Sox are playing Oakland this week, so there's more potential for disaster.
For goodness sakes, that doesn't look good.
Two buckets. It doesn't look good at all. It doesn't look good. And you will be delighted to know that I, like many in the Red Sox fan base, are calling for major upheaval. We'd like to see the team get shaken up a little bit. We'd like to see a big trade, shake it up a little bit, because I think that's how bad it is.
That's always worked in the past.
That's always, you know, that, yeah, because I knew you'd enjoy that.
Jerry time.
You know, Jerry, the thing is that what'll happen with that is it perhaps will cause more disaster than, you know, this team I thought was going to at least be contending.
Meanwhile, may I remind you, friends, look at the calendar. It's the 7th month. 3 weeks until training camp.
Wow.
1 month until the Hall of Fame game. That's NFL football coming back, baby.
See, I thought what you were going to say was that this is very unusual, because usually leading up to the All-Star break, the Red Sox are playing gangbusters and the Yankees are kind of heh-heh.
Mm-hmm.
So it's maybe it's the opposite this year.
Uh-huh. Sure it is, Mike.
See, now he, you know, it sucks. Now he's like Mr. Confident. They're not even giving you a run for it. I make a Red Sox bet with you, and the Red
Sox... Don't bring this on me, because I've not started the taunting. I mean, I'll taunt if you like, but
you know what?
It's too early to taunt.
Yeah. You're taunting.
Who brought it up?
You did. You did before
the
show.
No.
During the show, you had said something about it.
No, I don't think I did.
Yeah, you did.
I did not.
You said something maybe in the, it was either on air or off air.
I did not.
Yeah, you did.
10 games. 10 games. You better hope the Yankees plane crashes tonight.
You know what? It's just, this is the worst. They came off this series. I mean, I just hated it. I hated it so much. I'm so filled with angst.
I know.
All he did was play a Tom Gavin tape, and then you segued into it.
Yeah, that's what started. It was a Tom Gavin tape.
That's right.
Thank you.
Well, I just was taking
Thank you
so
for
long.
Your help once again. Let's start right back in with the same help.
So.
Okay.
Let me change the topic.
Yes,
Mike,
all right.
Hold on. Let me turn the spotlight on my best buddy, Rob, for a second.
Let's do that.
I think you'll enjoy this.
I doubt it.
But no, you will. No, hold on. You will.
Okay, all right.
Because.
All right.
Is it buffoonery?
Take a look at it. Now.
I gave him a look a minute ago.
I
gave him that look that when he helps you.
I still feel that look.
Yes.
take a look at him, and when you think of him, you think funny guy, loyal guy.
Jolly.
Guy, jolly. Athletics, not necessarily.
I've always thought that if he had ever, like, wanted to,
well, now
on size alone, he could have been a ball player.
We knew he was a gentle giant when we had a bowling team.
Right.
And Rob would bowl. Well, I'm here to tell you, I have never seen athletic excitement out of Rob like when we took his kids down to the boardwalk.
Right.
And we played all of the games. We played the shoot the water in the clown's mouth.
Love that game.
And make the balloon on top of his head blow up. Rob didn't win at that one the first time. He's really pissed. And Rob kept saying his game is whack-a-mole.
Oh whack-a-mole.
Yeah. This is the game.
As far as your carny games, that is one of the more skillful games.
Well.
Quick reflexes.
Get ready for this reaction. And now you describe it to our listeners.
All right.
Because we were up there. Rob was playing, I was playing, Frieda's playing, Kerry's playing, trying to win stuff for Rob's kid.
Sure.
And we're playing against a bunch of other people, like 15 players at this thing. Rob said, this is my game. First time, he did not win. He was mad.
I'm seldom defeated.
He was seldom defeated.
You mean you're a very confident whack-a-mole player?
Yes, he was beat mad. Me once, and you remember in California.
Yeah, we played, on the pier.
I was very upset then.
Santa Monica Pier,
He was mad like he had just struck out in the World Series.
Okay.
So he pulls out another dollar and gives it to the guy and says, this time I'm ready. And the light goes off, and now you got Rob with the mallet just whacking the moles. Now, when it's all done, 150, whatever it is.
Yeah,
Rob is the winner. Mike, I am not kidding. I ask you not. This is his reaction.
Oh no!
He won a stuffed toy.
Yeah, it was more than that.
It was like this. It was yes. Now you have to help me describe what he's doing.
He's jumping in place, like maybe about 2 inches around in a little circle.
He's holding the mallet in his hand, and he's going. Yes! Nobody beats me at this! Nobody beats me at whack-a-mole!
Right.
This is my game! Yes! He was actually jumping around.
That's a good thing.
I wish I could dispute it, but I can't. I can't. And you see what? I was
Well,
mad.
You don't participate in a lot of athletics.
No, I don't. I don't. And I was upset because my first thought was that the machine needed calibration. Because the first time through...
Blame the umpire.
I don't think I should have lost.
Right.
And then, you know, the doubts creep in. Have I lost my touch?
Your edge?
Yes. Yeah. And so when I won the second time, then I knew. I knew that I still had it.
But his reaction was, think about...
How many were you playing against?
I think the second time was seven.
Seven or eight.
And what would be the, you know, just as a ballpark figure for that type of competition, what would be the average age of the people you were playing against?
They were largely under eight and over 60.
But, Mike, think about, speaking of baseball, think about like a playoff game.
Right.
And a guy who hits a walk-off home run at the bottom of the ninth.
And they all do that jump up and down
thing. You know
thing
that now. Reaction?
Oh, yeah.
Or when Adam Vinatieri hit the field goal?
I don't know that reaction.
in the Super Bowl?
Sorry.
I know you've seen it before.
I've seen it
in black and white silence?
Yes. 1918.
I've seen it as well.
Right.
All right, so Rob's there with his kids.
Yes.
And we've got my sister-in-law and her husband and her kids.
You just had a house full, didn't
you? Yeah, we did, but I loved having them. I especially loved having Robert and Julia because Robert reminds me of a little Bart.
He's right, just, right.
You know, he's that age. He's blonde. He's about 2 years old. And then, you know, they're so easy. I was telling Rob, you can be a great dad and be lazy. Like, I had to hit Rob that you're sitting down on the beach with your kid.
Mm-hmm.
Robert would come over and have one of those little things that one of those plastic things you use to make a sandcastle.
Right, right.
And I said, finally said to Rob, this is the easiest lazy dad job in the world, but you're like a great dad because you're just sitting in your chair,
mm-hmm.
and the kid walks up to you and he says, which means make me a sandcastle because he's got the thing in his hand.
You don't get out of the chair.
No, so he gives it to me. I used to do the same thing with Bart.
And you sit there and make it right next to you.
And I fill it up. And then when I'm about ready to turn over, I go, what do you say? And he goes, it's a big smile. Please. Then you turn it around, and you say, Robbie, you want to push on it? You want to push on it? And he pushes on it, and you lift it up, and amazingly.
It's a miracle.
He's got, and then.
You've got a structure.
And he would want like four or five in a row.
Sure.
And then he would laugh like crazy as he stomped them down.
Sure.
And then it would be. More.
And you just sit there casually, and you can do it, and it's no effort required.
So I said to Rob, I said, being a good dad is not a big responsibility.
Well, it's like, it reminds me of the time when my kids were younger, when we used to play the walk on daddy's back game.
That's right.
Which okay. They still do.
Okay.
At 9 and 7, and soon to be 7, they still do.
So,
it's great. Lazy parenting. It's a wonderful thing.
You know, it's the togetherness that counts.
That's right.
Right.
Although, you know, I take it back. This is lazy, too, on my part. This is my kid all the time, too. Another way, when a kid is that small, Robert's 21 months old, very easy just to pick him up if you're sitting down.
Right.
You like sitting on a couch. You go, where's Robert? Get him to come over. You go, come here. Then you just lift him up in the air for a second. Just hold him over your head for like 5 seconds. Where is Robert? And he comes back down, and you do some of this on his belly.
Right. Right.
Laughs for like a
well,
half
that's
an hour.
That's effort. What? Were you still sitting?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I was sitting the whole time.
Yeah, but you're straining. You know, you're using the arms.
I've got the lazy dad thing down.
Right, just don't get me up.
Anyway, I loved having Rob and his family down and having my wife's sister down. It was great having all of them down. There were just two other things that I have to mention, and then we'll move on. One was about the dogs. Now, we bring the dogs with us on vacation because my wife loves the dogs. However,
you have 12 now, right?
This is what led to my comment with the S word, snob, with my wife.
Ooh.
My wife loves bringing the dogs to the beach with us. However, she hates the fact that occasionally the dogs go to the bathroom in the house.
Right.
This seems to me to be a fact. You're going to travel with dogs. Dogs are going to take a leak on the couch once in a while. They're going to get mad at you, and they're going to do something like this. So she's out of her mind with the dogs, and one day she and Carrie were out on a bike ride or something, and Rob has got the one kid and the other one sleeping, and Frida said to me, take the dogs out for a walk. So I said, sure. And now I've got the German Shepherd, and I've got the Collie and the Terrier. I've got a big dog and two little dogs. And we had gone out for a walk, and then I thought, again, wrong on my part, I'll do something to help around here. As it turns out, and you know, Buzz, I've heard this before, stay away from weed.
Yes.
Well, there were a bunch of weeds in our front yard.
Yeah.
And Frida said to me, you know, it'd be great if you were
really...
take
the dog in to do it in the tall weeds?
No. She said all she wanted me to do was get out in our little front yard there in our little condo place and just pull out the weeds. Just go out front, just do some
weeding. Oh, do some weeding.
Do some weeding.
All right. So, harvest the weeds.
So I go outside.
Hey, we're not talking about your vacation yet, okay?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
sorry.
Right, no,
got excited.
Different kind of weed.
All right.
Anyway, I'm down there pulling out these weeds, and I've got the dogs sitting there with me. Mm-hmm. And they're as happy as can be. Of course, it's the 4th of July week, and there's lots of people there. And at one point, somebody else walks by with a dog. An old guy who looks like Bob Barker walks by with a dog. And my dogs...
What type of weeds are you finding?
My dogs go nuts and go jumping on this guy. Colonel Klink, who's a big German Shepherd, is a puppy, but he is excited and...
Oh, my God, he snapped a femur.
Jumping on the guy. Now, the old guy, the Bob Barker-looking guy, screams at me. I'm standing in the middle of the street, and he says, "Control those animals! Your dog attacked me! There's a leash law in Ocean City! What kind of idiot lets his dogs out without a leash?" And I said, "Hey, listen, I'm very sorry. I was just doing some weeding in my front yard. They were sitting there." He said, "Your dog mauled me! Your dog attacked me!" Now,
oh, chill out.
Now, the dog did nothing of the sort. However, you know, you never know if someone's going to call, like, Humane Society. So I have to chase the dogs around, and they don't understand what's going on. I put them back inside the house, and I go out, and I find the guy. Now, the guy's still walking his dog down the street, and as it turns out, as I walk up behind the guy, he's talking to somebody else about me. He's already talking, he's saying, "Yeah, I don't know, there's a guy with three dogs, three ferocious dogs, and they didn't have leashes on.
And they had big, long fangs, look like someone out of the prehistoric era."
So then I go up to the guy, and I go, "Hey, listen, sir," because he's an old man, I call him, "sir, listen, sir, I'm really sorry about that. My dogs are very gentle. The big one is just a giant puppy. He's not ferocious. Well, he looked rather ferocious when he knocked me down. I wanted to say to him, you know, hello, old man, a feather could knock you down."
Yes, but you didn't want to say that.
And
no.
It was and the old man was not knocked down by the dog. I didn't point that out either. I just said,
"Look at that. This is my elbow sticking through the skin."
I said, We love dogs, we have dogs. I said, "I'm very sorry that my dogs were not on the leash. I apologize." And the guy would not let it go. The guy said, "Well, I accept your apology. However, you must leash those animals." And he was doing it that loudly because he had a show going on.
Oh, he's a hump.
Because there are people that are watching. And there was one part of me that just wanted to say, "Hey, listen, old man. You know, why don't you crawl in the hole with Marlon Brando? I bet there's room." But I was waiting for you. I said, "I apologize, and you know, I'll keep them on the leash." And he said, "All right, I accept your apology." And I thought, okay, this is a confrontation that's worked out okay.
Yeah.
I'm about halfway down the street, I hear the guy yell out again, "If I ever see that again, I'm calling animal control."
Oh, so you see.
He had to get the last word in.
Did you turn around?
No, I didn't. I didn't, because I got to live there, and my wife's got to live there.
But that's a typical guy that makes too big a deal of it.
That's an Ocean City thing. And then another time, the dogs were barking. I guess it was 8 o'clock in the morning, and they were out on the deck. And, you know, they bark when they see anything.
Right.
And a guy that lives across the street from me was sitting on his deck. Sunday morning, 8 o'clock. Now, it's a quiet time, but it's Ocean City. It's a resort community.
Right.
So the dogs see something, they bark, and the guy from across the street yells at me, "Hey, shut those animals up." Guy sitting down on his porch. Some guy and a wife beater. And I said, "Okay, I'll do the best I can." I shut the sliding glass doors. About 10 minutes later, open back up. The dog sees something, they bark. And now the guy stands up and goes, "Hey! I told you, shut those dogs up." Now, how are you going to respond to this?
With a finger?
No. And again, I couldn't. And you know why I couldn't? Because I already had a strike against me.
Right.
The strike against me that I had, the reason that I couldn't yell at this guy for yelling at me about my dogs, do you know what my son, the genius, had done the day earlier? He had gone out in the middle of the street and decided to fire off bottle rockets right in the middle of the street in front of all these condos and townhouses.
Yeah, that's not exactly a rural area.
And I guess everybody, all of the people who were on Rear Window, because it's like the Hitchcock movie.
Oh, I want to thank my neighbors, though, because I didn't go to see any 4th of July fireworks. Mm-hmm. We had a great show just on Neighbors. I live, you know, out there, you know where I live, mm-hmm. out in farm country out there. Farm country people make their own fun, and man, great illegal fireworks shows.
All right,
really, really terrific.
Well, I had to end up again apologizing to this guy.
Yeah. You're pretty concentrated down there. It sounds like it causes tension because you're.
It does.
You're there. Just too many people in there. They're the same people that wait in the traffic to get over that bridge and then wait in the traffic to get back. So everybody's just wrapped tight the whole time.
There's a lot of people. A lot of old people just set out on their decks and wait for someone to park where they're not supposed to park, uh-huh. so that they can call the cops to watch them get towed.
They're just nasty.
And And they also love yelling at people. Like, yeah. A guy will pull his car in, and the woman next door actually yelled over and said, you're a little over the middle line there. And here's some old broad in her house coat at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. You know, she probably smells like the inside of my shoe out there with her Beatrice Arthur outfit on, having a Virginia Slims and a Bloody Mary at 2:30 in the afternoon, yelling at a guy going, you're a little over the line there, sweetheart.
Because it's their property, right?
Yeah, and Rob, you observe these people with
so,
me.
You are so good at the rear window game, and it's just a fascinating thing to watch. Because in front of you is a tableau. Now, in many neighborhoods, you get a neighbor to watch. You have like 16, and it's so much fun to just sit and watch the day unfold, and I think we got pretty good at it.
Yes, we did. We started identifying the people
that just like to bitch about.
Yes, well, and we refer to them in Hollywood Squares, like, you know, Center Square. Oh, look at Center Square's there.
Right.
Hey, look at Upper Left is at home.
Just getting upset about stuff.
Yeah, and we used to love watching it. I mean, we spent all week watching it. Then
wonderful plots unfolding.
We went to Secrets, and our wives got drunk and danced with two idiotic guys. One guy looked like John Elway, and the other guy looked like
Marty Bass. So that was another good show.
No, that was a good show with our wives getting drunk and dancing with strangers.
The John Elway guy was real big to do a high energy dance across the floor, come up and sort of point at Carrie or Frida, and the eyebrows go up, and then dance backwards to see if they'd follow.
And you guys weren't hopping up on the floor, huh?
No, we were not.
We weren't having
it. He invited you directly.
Yeah. Guy was so drunk at Secrets. Guy, he's out there dancing by himself, dancing with their wives. He came up to me, out of all the people in the bar, he comes up to me and goes, hey, how about it? I said, I'm no homo. And he said, I'm not a homo either. I just need some security out here.
Wow.
Thanks, drunkie.
It was a good show. And then there was also the Paris Hilton and Nicole Richie show, where we were just waiting for one of them to fall.
There was a girl in Secrets, and this was early 9:30.
You see that look around a lot. A lot of people are trying to recreate that Paris Hilton look.
She had a real nice, she was a good-looking girl, had a nice jean outfit on, nice jean skirt on. She walked back against the wall and literally slid almost all the way down to her feet. She barely caught herself, and she was one of those drunk people, Mike, that when she would walk around, she would go like to the left, she would go to the right.
She'd been at the place for the fishbowl margarita.
She had.
Oh, more than one. And then there was a guy in a cowboy hat who was terribly handsome, and the pickup line that was actually used on Paris Hilton and Nicole Richie, was this tool goes up and says,
oh, hold on, this is good.
You are sexy. And I'm just like, this can't possibly
work. How was the dental work on the guy with the cowboy hat?
Dental work is non-existent on all those people.
There you go. Hi-yi.
Very crisp T-shirt.
Non-existent. But having said all of that, there's no place better than Ocean City. This better than Ocean City to go see a movie like Spider-Man with all the, you know, all the tourists, the people, the kids that are screaming. The only thing I got is just my wife. Just at one point, we had a giant fight at the beginning of the vacation, and then halfway through the vacation, it was a tender moment, just she and I, alone on the beach, talking about life, talking about decisions.
That's nice.
And at one point, I won't go into great detail, but I just said to her, I said, you know, I got something I want to say to you. I don't know how to say it. And she said, well, whatever it is, just say it. And I said, you're going to be offended. Never mind. And, you know, as soon as you start down that road, you're going to have to. And I finally just, okay, I'm just going to say it. You're a snob. And apparently that is like the worst word that I could possibly
use. She didn't like that.
No, she did not. She did not. And she said, well, give me an example where I'm a snob.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess one of the examples was we were discussing Krispy Kremes.
Okay.
Yeah, we all had a hankering. Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. Hey, that deserves a round of applause.
We had a hankering. Rob and Carrie and the kids and Frida and I were up, and we think, who would like some Krispy Kremes?
Mm-hmm.
And Frida looked at us incredulously and said, who would go to a Krispy Kreme? And I said, who would go to a Krispy Kreme? Baby Annie, everybody goes to Krispy Kreme. She says, well, now they're full of fat and sugar and they're not good for you. I said,
of course not.
I said, yes. And she said, very proudly, she said, I've never had one. I said, well, would you like one? She said, oh, no, I don't even want, oh, I, no, I don't want to go. And she said, you know what I really think Ocean City needs? I think that they could use like a good whole grain bread store. And I just looked at her and I said, what happened to the girl that I married? You know, I love you like you are.
Sure.
And we all change and we all evolve, but darling, you have become a snob.
Whole grain breads.
And then once,
nothing like that fried dough, though.
Kids love them at the beach.
Once I called her a snob, that was like worse than if I had called her the word.
The bad word?
Yeah, I mean.
And it went downhill from there?
Snob, she said, I can't believe the way you talked to me on the beginning of the vacation, and I can't believe that you're saying this to me now.
Was this at the end of the vacation?
This was towards the end.
Yeah.
And then I managed to pull it together a little bit towards the very end. And I think she's all right now, but even today, she was whim-whammy again today.
Well, that's probably the snob thing.
Well, no, she's past that now.
Mm-hmm.
She's past that. I mean, like, one of the things I said to her, really, she said, well, why do you think I'm a snob? I said, and we can have a dialogue. I said, what you don't realize is you spend pretty much half of your life telling me what a loser I am. And don't get me wrong. On the other hand, she's my best friend, my confidant. She tells me how great I am, but she also tells me how bad I am. I said, so like, I figure, what's the worst?
Like your vacation was a little whim-whammy.
What's the worst you're going to say to me? I'm fat. I said, I know I'm fat. You
right.
Tell me it all. She says,
that's the important thing, incidentally. And this is a message to all fat people. Would you agree with this?
What?
Know that you're fat.
Yeah. She said,
if you don't know you're fat, you're in trouble.
She said to me, well, I don't tell you that you're fat. I said, no, but come on. You say it. And why is like you say, you know, do you really need that? Do you really? Don't you think it would be better to get something healthy? Blah, blah. Even though I do all the stuff that I'm supposed to do, it's just, you know, I'm just fat. Just deal with it. I said, so in like my mind, that's the worst thing you could say to me is that I'm fat. So I'm going to say now the worst thing in my mind. I said, I think you're a snob. And I said, no, not all the time you're not a snob. It's just sometimes. She said, like, when? And I said, okay, I give you a. I thought of this recently, didn't tell you that I think you're a snob. When you said to me with a straight face that you were very excited because there was a sale at Neiman Marcus. And she said, what's wrong with that? And I said, what's wrong with that? There's no such thing as a sale at a store like Neiman Marcus.
What's wrong? Maud!
You want a sale? You know, go to Target.
Yes.
You don't get a sale at Neiman Marcus. She said, well, the shoes that I bought were on sale. I said, well, you know, I don't care how much they reduced them to. Still, you could go out and buy 20 pairs of shoes at Payless.
Go get them.
For what discounts. And I don't care that you buy it. I'm glad that you're happy. Just be honest about the fact that in some ways, you are a snob.
And she didn't like that.
No, she didn't. She maintained she was not a snob.
Did you back away from that at all? Or?
Yeah, I had to because, you know, I got to live with her.
Yeah.
So I had to back
That's
away
part
from
of the
it.
Deal.
I had to back away from it. And then, you know, then I had to hear the lecture about, you know, what a bad person I am. And that, yes, she might be a snob, but at least she's nicer to people than I am. And why I'm very rude and I yell at people all the time. Mm-hmm. Look at me. I like to sit out on the porch and just make fun of people all the time.
That's a good activity.
And
like, yeah.
Well, you would sit out there all night if you could with Rob and just talk about how stupid and dumb and ugly everybody else is.
It's healthy.
Well, yes, I would.
That's the activity.
Yes, I would.
Cherry time.
then it was okay.
And then it was time to come home.
It was okay. Yeah, well, the 4th of July. We can't forget that.
No.
Can't forget that. We can't just watch the fireworks from where we watch them every year. We have to take an 8-block remote trip to go to this park to see them, which is fine, except we have an 80-year-old woman with us. We have my wife's mom with us, and she can't walk the 10 blocks in 90-degree weather. So my wife comes up with this brilliant plan. She says, what you're going to do is you're going to drive all of us over to this 8-block, and on the 4th of July, it gets crowded as hell in Ocean City. It's like Times Square.
Yeah.
You're going to drive us all over there, and you're going to drop us off because there's no parking. Then you'll inch your way back to the house. Mm-hmm. Then you'll get on a bicycle, and you'll ride your bicycle back over to watch the fireworks with us. Then when you're done watching the fireworks, you'll get on your bicycle and ride your bicycle back home mm-hmm. and get the car and fight the traffic and come back and pick us up.
Perfect.
And I said to her, that is the most bass-ackwards idea I've ever heard in my life. So you know what we ended up doing? I ended up driving them over in the car and dropping them off because my mother-in-law can't walk 10 blocks in 80-degree weather, whatever it was. I went back with the bike, and then what we did was we put my mother-in-law on the bicycle, and we simply walked the bike all the way back home.
That was a good solution.
See how we got around
that? That was a very good solution.
Yes. How we got
and you probably
around.
Got home quicker than you would have if you'd had the car thing.
I believe
oh,
so.
Yeah. Was that your idea?
It was, Mike.
How did she enjoy the bike ride?
My mother-in-law or my wife?
Your mother-in-law.
My mother-in-law loved it.
Was it okay on the bike?
Yeah, it was fine on the bike. My wife hated it.
Oh, really?
Because my wife kept saying, lean more this way. You're leaning too much to the right. You're leaning too much to the right. Right. Meanwhile, you know, we're walking down a street and people are leaving the fireworks. 200,000 people are leaving the fireworks.
You know what you need? You need one of them mopeds.
And as it turns out, we're going by the sides of cars. I'm getting pushed against...
Can tell when he's worked up, I make a suggestion and he blasts
Mike,
right
I hear,
by,
I hear the moped thing.
The moped thing would
I hear
work
the
for
moped
you.
Thing, but the road is crowded with mopeds.
Yeah.
I told her, we really need a rickshaw.
Don't be all whim-whammy on me.
That's what we need is a rickshaw. I'm not, Mike, I am anything but whim-whammy. I am opinionated to a fault.
Jerry Todd.
Jerry Todd.
I know what I'm talking about. I know what I want to talk about. And that's all I want to talk about. That's it. It's only taken me 2 hours to get it all out today. And this was a good vacation.
Yeah.
Keep in mind, this was a good vacation.
If it was a bad vacation, we'd still be going.
Yeah. No,
I mean, there'd be more to tell.
See, the thing is, I'm a firm believer. Who wants to come back? And I had plenty of great times.
Right.
Who wants to hear that? Who right. wants to hear I had the greatest time and my wife's the greatest, Rob's kids are the greatest, my kid's the greatest, we all laughed, we played cards. You don't want to hear that.
No.
You don't want to hear that. You want to hear me grabbing my wife's bicycle and not allowing her to move, and then the guy...
You know, it came full circle, though. It starts out where you're grabbing your wife's bicycle and you're supporting her on the bicycle as you're having a tug of war, and then you end up supporting your mother-in-law on a bicycle.
Yeah.
Isn't that kind of weird the way that works?
Yes, it is.
Oh, question. It's a strange time, Jerry.
Yes,
the new lesbian lover you haven't revealed yet.
Oh.
Jerry Todd.
That would be Carrie Spiewak.
I thought so.
There was dancing and there was also touching.
Touch dancing.
There was touch dancing.
Right, you know, enough
with our wives.
This whole lesbian thing, yeah. You know, I'm tired of hearing it. As an outsider on this subject, yeah. Okay, with Buzz's wife and with Rob's wife, mm-hmm. You bring up that lesbian thing when they really close the deal.
Well, I think...
That's when I want to hear about it. That's when I want to really hear about it, okay?
I think they might have been ready for it. A couple more drinks on Wednesday night, they could have gone for it.
Who was the aggressor?
As always, my wife.
Yeah. Yeah.
As always, my wife.
So now it's a race to close the deal.
Yep. That's right.
Yeah, you can give your wife a talking to, can't you, Buzz?
Yeah.
We'll
right,
get
so
back home.
That's it. That's all I got. Thank you for allowing me this time. I won't have to go
see
my...
Do you feel like you purged? Do you feel like you've gotten it out of your system?
Yes, I don't have to go see my therapist now. My wife is at work today. She's not even going to... I won't even get any crap for saying this on the radio until tomorrow, until she finds out about it.
Very good.
So things are great. Thank you very much. Had a great vacation. Very glad to be back. When we come back... Mike, I would like to know... Well, I
this
know
will it. Not be a vacation recap when we come back. This will be a series of thank yous to some very important people.
You are...
Starting with my children and working its way all the way up to my good friend, Mr. Victor Tiffany. What a marvelous time I had at his casino, the Borgata.
Hotel Borgata.
Wonderful time.
I told you... When
and I would not let the Red Sox ruin my vacation. They tried, but I wouldn't let them do it, you see. And I'm back, and I'm still a fan. I'm as much of a fan as I was before. But I'm not going to let those bastards ruin my vacation.
Good. And you know, on Wednesday, I know you knew, whenever the last time is that we talked, when you were on your way to Atlantic City, Mike was just as happy as can be.
And I got to a point, seriously, on the vacation where... Dom would call me, and when I would see the phone ring, I mean, I would lunge at it because it was, I mean, you know, some pretty darn pleasant conversations, and it was very all the news. I mean, we've had how many times have we gone away where we're going back and forth to see who can give each other the worst news about stuff we're dealing with. This was one of those pleasant
that's
times.
That's good. And at one point we were chatting, and it was deathly quiet in my house. There was no television on, no radio on, no satellite radio, no nothing. And Mike called, and he was on his way to Atlantic City, and I'm having a jovial chat, and he said, "So how are things going?" And I had to go upstairs and shut the door. And I said, very quietly, I just said, "It's very la-la right here."
And I know la-la now.
We all do. And do you know, when I hung up the phone, I swear to God, I go downstairs, and both Carrie and Frida said to me, What did you want to tell Mike that you didn't? Now, keep in mind, I'm a floor upstairs. She says, we heard you say it's la-la time, and then you close the door.
Jesus.
Well, I love vacation, but I love coming back even more.
It's great to be back.
Great to be back.
It's like, and listen, that Spider-Man, that movie kicks some ass.
Looking forward to taking my kids to it.
Just like the comic. Just like the comic. Just like it.
Better than the first one.
What they did was they took like 12 or 13 issues of the comic and condensed it into one movie.
The movie's getting 10 times the reviews that it got the first time around.
And it's Tobey Maguire. Because if you read the comic, he is Peter Parker. He's too good. The thing is freaking great. Phew, man.
You better sit down.
Me so tired. Really me so tired.
Oh, you need to relax. You should enjoy Atlantic City.
We'll be right back, Mike.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gee whiz, gang. Looks like the killer gutted the victim, strangled him with his own intestines, and then dumped the body in the river. You're right, Scoob. We're dealing with one sick son of a bitch.
The Don and Mike Show.
Don't think me unkind. Words are hard to find.
Jerry Todd, everybody.
When the eloquence escapes me, then logic ties me up and takes me.
Yeah, Jerry Todd.
Do 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 do, da da da. All I wanna be saying to you, da do 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 do, da 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 da. The innocence will pull me through, do 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 do, da 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 da.
That was Jerry Todd, everybody.
Jerry Todd.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Right.
Hello.
Hi there, Julia.
Jerry Todd.
Like the Girl Scouts, they have changed. Don and Mike.
Right. Right.
So think me.
That's close enough to 5:30.
Yeah, absolutely.
Got the bullhorn?
Well, no, we probably shouldn't.
It's 15 minutes.
You know, why mess it up?
We haven't already messed it up?
Not as much as it would be. I mean, you know.
It's 15 minutes.
There's the bullhorn.
All right, it's by Alan. Hey, what are you doing? Pick up your phone. Hold on. You ever want to call him at home, just dial 460.
That's how you get Alan's home, right?
That's his extension.
Nice to see he's available as usual.
He's busy. And when, incidentally, he's not Alan, he's Yalen.
Yalen?
Hi, this is Yalen.
Hello, this is Yalen Line One.
Not Alan, it's Yalen.
This is Yalen Line One.
Yalen?
Hi, it's Yalen.
Hi, Yalen.
Hey, it's Yalen.
Hello, this is Alan Line One.
Yalen.
Community Broadcasting, WJFK Radio. I'm unavailable right now, so
Yalen.
Your name, number, right. Brief message, and I'll get back to you as soon as possible. Thank you, and have a nice day.
Oh.
I'll record your message at the tone. When you're finished, hang up or stay on the line for further options.
Alan, stand by for an important message. Go ahead.
Hello?
Go ahead, Tom.
Hey, buddy.
Hi.
Hey, guys.
Leave a message for Alan.
Hey, Alan.
Go ahead, Tom. Leave him a message.
Hey, Alan, what are you doing, man? This is Satan.
Good message.
Okay, thanks, Tom.
Hey.
What, Tom?
When am I coming in?
For what?
For the baseball.
For a long time, Tom.
Bye, Tom.
When the season's over.
Goodbye, Tom.
Bring a bucket.
Goodbye, Tom. Goodbye, Alan. All right, we'll wait a couple of minutes to make that announcement. Mike, tell us what you... On your vacation?
Series of thank yous.
Here we go.
Really, no negatives to bring to the table.
Good.
A series of wonderful thank yous. I'd like to thank my beautiful daughters, Catherine and Elizabeth, for a fabulous time up in the mountains. I'd like to I'd like to thank my girlfriend Carla for just having a great time on the 4th of July. And I'd also like to thank Victor Tiffany.
Now
at the Borgata Hotel and Casino.
Now hold on.
Director of the restaurants there.
Regular listeners of the show might remember Mike and I were going to Vegas.
Yeah.
And we had this guy, you and I had been to Atlantic City.
Right.
We were going to be making a road trip to Vegas.
Yes.
And Rob booked this guy on.
The guy, because he runs the restaurants, the food and beverage, at the Borgata Hotel and Casino. And he was coming on to talk about a scotch, McCallum scotch.
Right. Costs $4,000.
That you can buy for $4,000 a shot.
Right.
And I think the way it ended was, you know, I said, I go down there quite often. Can I call you? He said, anytime you want to come down, call me. So I'm sitting there at the Borgata Hotel and Casino waiting to see if I can get my room comped. And
Jerry Todd.
I said during the whole thing, I said, I might want to call my friend Rob to remind myself of what this guy's name was that came on the show. When I called Rob, he said, how could you possibly forget? His name was Victor Tiffany.
And it was so great. It was left with an email. I sent him a thank you note. And he said, Rob, it was a pleasure speaking to the boys. Tell Bob and Mike their rooms are waiting at the Borgata.
So Mike is in Atlantic City.
Now here's the deal.
And actually calls this guy.
Wow. Hold on, I got a backup here, all right?
We had on the show.
I have to back up and explain to you that when we got down to the casino, I was unable to secure two rooms consecutively because of one reason. I believe that they were unaware of the fact that when I come to play.
Well,
and the way it works, Don, in casino hotels, if I can explain this to our listeners who may not be familiar with it.
Please do, Mike.
The way it works in the world of casino hotels is the treats that you receive, the swag that you get, the pamperedness that you receive, that you're on the receiving end line.
And if I could, hold on.
Yes.
I told you this before, I'll say it publicly.
Yes.
A couple of months ago when you started saying swag.
Yes, swag.
And I said, get out of here.
I love swag. I like the swag.
I said, get out of here with that. I read a book over vacation by the real Donnie Brasco.
Right.
And
Buzz gave me that book for my birthday. Huh?
He mentions the word swag and says wise guys like their swag. And I can't tell you, every time I read it, the thought went through my mind of me looking at you and going, you're a dope. Nobody uses that word.
Do you know what? Really, and it's interesting you bring this up, because I think I said this over the weekend, that the whole reason I think I like this whole thing of going to casinos and trying to get freebies out of this stuff is because they make you feel like a gangster.
How lucky can one guy
be? No, they really do. The way it is, you get treated if you play a lot, and you know, and it doesn't necessarily matter how much you lose, which is important. It's how much you play,
right?
You know, that's what Robert De Niro says. And so I call this casino host, and a casino host is somebody who's supposed to hook you up. They're supposed to get you a room. They're supposed to get you taken care of. And that's you know, if anybody's watched that television show Casino that's on now, you get a little, you know, a little perspective on this. I'm not like the guys that come on that show.
Oh, you know, we just blew somebody off because we're running so late today. A guy, anybody that watched Casino on Fox last Monday night, the guy that they caught counting cards.
I watched that. I TiVo'd that, and I hadn't seen that
one. I don't know. We got the guy, but we missed his interview. Oh, and also, unrelated, the girl that we had on from Love or Money.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Rachel.
The slutty one. She lost last night. However, they have selected her to come back and be the girl who picks the guy on the next edition.
Oh, fantastic. Good.
For Love or Money.
Well, she's very hot.
Mm-hmm.
But let me finish my story, man.
Sorry, Victor.
So here's the deal. You what you do, and this is the voice that I use. You have to show them that you have a certain level of play. Now, it's no secret to any of our listeners that I have developed a certain reputation at the Venetian Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada, with my casino host, Jacqueline Vargas.
Jacqueline Vargas.
So when I called down to the Borgata and I had this card that I had received from the last time I did a walkthrough, she said, call me and we'll set something up. So I call her and I say, you know, can I get down? We'll come down Sunday night and Monday night. You know, so kind of that time that usually you're open in the casinos. Well, that wasn't the case. She said, well, I don't know how much you play. I said, well, you can call my casino host at the Venetian and she will tell you. She said, well, you could call
her. So in other words, they need a reference from another hotel.
In other words, if I may be, without mentioning names, if I can be very honest and brutally honest, Don, what I will tell you is that she is being, in a word, difficult.
Mm.
Very difficult.
That's Buddy Rich.
There you go, baby. Thank you. I'll get totally distracted when you play this particular song. Ladies and gentlemen, Sammy Davis Jr.
Hear my voice.
But anyway, so she's giving me a little bit of a hard time because she doesn't know that I play and that I play these.
She
moron.
Doesn't know you're a player, baby.
Right.
Technically, yes.
That when I go down for a very brief period of time, win or lose, I'm going to gamble because I like to gamble.
And I know you don't.
I like gambling.
I know you don't like to talk about the amount of money, and I won't embarrass you. I'll just say, kids' college educations. Very often on a weekend,
mm-hmm.
are on the line with you.
Right. Well, it's not that way though. I mean, it's not I put aside, I plan for it, and I put aside what I can afford, and everybody should afford to lose down there. And I try to make sure that I'm not betting the rent money or anything like that.
No, you're not. But the amount of money that I don't want to get ahead of myself here.
Mm-hmm.
But
yes.
Yeah, golden boy here.
Oh. You know, I want to get to that at the very end of things.
You know, he is down there betting a large amount of money.
Yeah.
But I guess it pays off.
Well, when
you all win a baby.
What I've done is I don't like to carry cash and I don't like to carry a lot of money with me. And so what you do is you establish a line of credit with a casino. And what a line of credit in a casino is you go in, they check your background and they do, they check your bank account and they said, okay, we'll offer you this. Bottom line is you have a certain amount of time where you got to pay that off. Or you're in trouble. You can have it for, it's basically giving you a free loan for a period of time so you can gamble that money in the casino. So I get that, I go down there, and we've only gotten one night. We had to go down to one hotel and move into the Borgata on the second night, which was kind of a pain, and I was kind of bummed out about it. But once we got down there, I said, okay, well, you know what I'm also going to do? I'm going to call Rob, and I'm going to get that guy's name. And the guy's name is
Victor Tiffany.
So it was just funny to hear that name, and I call him on his machine. I get his answering machine. I said, Victor Tiffany, this is Mike O'Mara, the Don and Mike Show. You were on the show talking about your incredible scotch that you sold for $4,000 a shot, and I just wanted to say hello. You asked to call. 5 minutes goes by. I get a call from this lady. She runs the restaurants down there, and she says, Victor Tiffany would like to host you for dinner. I said, that's very nice of Mr. Tiffany. We'll take him up in your finest steakhouse and enjoy a fabulous evening. And, of course, she said, now, no ordering the $4,000 a shot scotch. And I said, I won't. But that didn't stop me from getting a huge lobster.
How big?
5.5 pounds.
Cherry Todd.
It was the only size they had. It was as big as a sea monster. It was absolutely, this sea monster was on my plate. It was fabulous.
And, Beanie and Cecil.
So we're all checked in, and it is a beautiful, beautiful hotel. It's fantastic. You know, after this initial... Oh,
here's the alligator.
And I hate to be negative.
Excuse me. Lobster.
I hate to be negative about, because the overall, the experience was positive. But this casino host, who I will not hopefully have to deal with again, after all that crap that she put me through about, hey, we don't know if you play or anything like that, the other host came. She was off the day we checked in. She came, so you're booked for Thursday. This is Monday afternoon. I said, no. So, I mean, I mattered so little with my level of play that she thought it was important to book me in the hotel for Thursday. We had already checked out of the other place. Conceivably, if they hadn't had a room that night, I might have been SOL in that situation. But we had a fabulous dinner with Victor Tiffany's compliments, and it was wonderful. And then, of course, to the tables an evening of play that resulted in tremendous ups. And tremendous Don. Tremendous drama, Don. It was tremendous.
You want me to come with you?
What? I don't know.
What the hell is that?
ZZ Top, Viva Las Vegas.
Oh.
What the hell is this? Take this one out, Rob.
This one sucks.
I got a better one.
You got a better one?
I do.
Hold on a second.
Well, let me tell you.
On a warm summer's eve.
Uh-huh. I went to the well and was almost down to my last. And usually I go down for two nights and I bring, what I want. And the whole key is to, enjoy yourself. If you have to lose, don't lose it all at one time. And I was almost out. And then, of course, the fortunes once again smiled upon me. And now let me suffice to say that I'm regarded very, very highly at the Borgata. No, not highly. I'm not compared to what some guys do down there, really, and I've talked to you about the details of that. I'm nothing compared to the majority of people down
there. But still, I listen
to these. But still, I mean, I get treated well.
I listen to your stories.
I get treated well.
And love living for you vicariously.
Yeah, I know you love the gambling, and you love me to give you the updates, win and lose.
Because you know what I
get into both
months?
Of them, whether I win or whether I lose. You know.
You're at the Borgata getting upgraded. I'm at Billy's sub shop talking to some kid from Slobavia trying to say, three double long meatball subs. Meanwhile, you're down there talking to your hostess, getting in your room.
Well, it was the two nights of my...
Oh, I'm jealous of that.
It was the two nights of my entire vacation where I just did it for me.
I know,
me.
I'm
and,
jealous.
Know, Buzz was talking about his vacation with me and said, you know, you have that little time for yourself.
That's
and,
right.
And it was really, you know, all about me doing something that I like to do. And it was a blast. And the winning part was secondary because it really... But it did, you know, it pulled you out of the abyss.
I
was feeling really like, you know, maybe it's time to call the hotline. You know, hello, I have a little gambling problem. And then out of that, you know, ding, ding, ding.
Wow.
Yes, sir.
And that's all. Now you're in the high roller slots, right?
Yeah. That's what I play, and I got very fortunate I think probably five times.
Wow.
Five times. But I mean, you got to consider that's what I do. So, I mean, I'm losing, you know, I'm losing, winning, losing, winning, losing. And this is one of those rare, rare times when you leave way ahead. And it just has happened to me on two separate visits. So I happen to be very, very happy. Very, very pleased with the way things. And yes, the GB logo is, I'm going to have shirts made of.
Oh, boy.
It really worked. And I know, what I know now, though, I'm smart enough to know that this gambling thing, I believe in what Robert De Niro says. In the end, they get it all.
Sure. Yeah.
And so this is a run that I'm having right now, and I don't know if it's going to last, but it's sure fun trying. The nice thing about it is when you have a run like this, you're playing with house money, so you can continue to gamble, and the more you do that, that's when they want you.
That's
and if you
like.
Win, they want you back, and so that's it. Mm-hmm. So if you ever need anything, you just mention my name. Get a good seat. And thank you to Victor Tiffany
for the lobster.
Did I mention we played Pictionary?
Uh-huh.
And we played Password. Sitting out on the deck, we played Password.
How wonderful for you.
That sucked.
That's what you said to me when I talked to you. Man, I wish I was you or something like that.
I did. Because I was up there with screaming kids, my wife yelling at me, and Mike calling from the car. I go, where are you going? I'm on my way to Atlantic City, baby.
You know, really, the difference between Las Vegas and Atlantic City is, you know, you have Las Vegas, where you get people coming in from Los Angeles, and you get the beautiful people, the jet setters, and then you still get Atlantic City, where... You want to talk about God's waiting room? That is really God's waiting room.
Yeah.
There was a guy, I came off the elevator the last day when we were leaving.
Loose nickel slot.
That's right.
I came off of the elevator. I was looking at a man. He was at the edge of the slot machines. He had a walker and a wheelchair and a cane. He had all three. He was sitting there. I looked at him for about 30 seconds because I seriously thought he was dead.
Mm-hmm.
I thought he was dead. He was ashen gray, and I got up a little close, and I said, you know, I really think, and just about then, he went, and he looked around. I'm like, no!
He's alive. I can make it all better done. Next time, we'll go to High Dollar Whack-A-Mole.
There you go.
Whack-A-Mole.
Yes.
Whack-A-Mole. Well, suffice it to say, but you are, again, the golden boy.
And just so you know, it wasn't all, you know, gambling in Atlantic City. I had a great week with my kids up in the mountains, and we went into, you know, we got a condo up in the mountains, and it was fantastic, and I taught them how to play blackjack. No, I'm kidding.
Stand by now, Mike, for a major announcement.
It's time.
We have two commercials, though. It's an announcement that's only major to you and me.
This is true. Are you going to tease through commercials, or are you going to do it now?
Oh, no, tease.
Tease.
After the commercials.
Wow.
That's right. Opera. Big announcement. Wait till you hear it. Wow, you're going to really be glad you sat through 9 minutes of commercials for this announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, this man is lying.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
In the casino, the cardinal rule is to keep them playing and keep them coming back. The longer they play, the more they lose. In the end, we get it all.
Not Mike.
The Don and Mike Show.
Noted Bonesman, Don Geronimo, and Michael Mera.
Right. We do have a new affiliate list. We can tell you definitely that we are heard every day in Pittsburgh. On WURP.
Work.
Wausau, Wisconsin. On WRIG in Brownsville, Texas. K KBJY. We have 4 brand new stations starting in the next 2 weeks that we're not allowed to talk about. However, we can tell you that starting tomorrow, we return to Tampa Bay, Florida.
Great to be back on in Tampa Bay.
Right? You got to... Where's that? Dun, 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 dun. Oh, there it is. Thank you, Rob. The Tampa Bay fanfare. Yeah. Tampa Bay was one of the first cities when our show was first syndicated 10 years ago.
Right.
Was one of the first cities that we were on, and we got great response there. Our rating sucked, but we got great response. We even thought about going down there to do a remote one time.
Beautiful Tampa, Florida. Love that town.
Mm-hmm. We do love Tampa, and fortunately for us, because the FCC... Oh, hi, FCC. Still doing all the crazy stuff with Howard. The company to get Howard on in some markets that he wasn't on before and get him back in some other markets said, hey, how about Tampa? Well, he said, what about 10 a.m.?
Sure.
So Howard is going to do mornings and then we'll do afternoons. Howard doesn't start for a couple of weeks.
Right.
But I had a conversation with the management team down there today. And anyway, we'll start tomorrow. They wanted us to wait until 5:30. Because there were people that had to be fired.
We are looking forward to coming back on in Tampa, Florida.
So anyway, tell the
WQYK, right?
That's it. Tell the 12 or 13 people that listened to us 10 years ago that we'll be back in Tampa starting tomorrow. And these other markets are very exciting, but we're supposed to keep them top secret.
Okay. We'll let you know as soon as we can.
So that's tomorrow. We'll reinvent ourselves in Tampa Bay. Also tomorrow, it starts tonight, the ESPN World Series of Poker.
Ah, hallelujah.
We're going to have one of the players on the show tomorrow. Plus, the Amazing Race starts tomorrow. Either one of the guys that was on it before or one of the guys that started another reality show. I told Beth Ann earlier today, I've seen the ads, and no offense to Scott the Dwarf.
Okay?
No offense to any Orientals. Hold on.
You know that thing?
Yeah,
that famous thing.
Parcells, where is he?
I got two guys, Sean Payton and Mike Zimmer. You got to keep an eye on those two. Because they're going to try to get the upper hand on. Mike wants the defense to do well. And Sean, he's going to have a few, no disrespect to the Orientals, but what we call jap plays.
No disrespect. No disrespect to the little people.
Of course not.
But I did see on the new Amazing Race that starts tonight, there is a midget team.
They've got a little person team.
Or it's one regular and one midget.
I may be mistaken. One of that team, they're cousins.
Yeah, and
one of them is from Towson.
One of them is regular sized and the other is a little person.
Anyway, I thought one was regular sized, the other was huge.
We'll get some of them.
All I know is I saw a clip from it when they start the race, you know, when they all run.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, isn't it? I saw it too. It's the best part.
The best part.
So that's coming up tomorrow on the show. Plus, very soon, Stan Lee, the guy that invented Spider-Man.
Yes.
I want to talk about the movie with him. And you should all keep in mind that we have our fantasy football draft, which will be happening.
When the hell is that?
A month or so. Okay.
Yeah, that's like August, right? It's going to be August in a month.
Wow. Yes, it is. It's today's July 6th.
No.
They go to training camps in 3 weeks. You got the Hall of Fame game coming up.
Oh, where the hell is the summer going?
I don't know. Here you go. Mike, how about this? I'm sure you, like me, very upset about the Olsen twins.
Oh, I feel so bad. I thought it was an eating disorder, and now it's, you know, it's the great white powder.
Yes, it is. And this time, the Star and the Enquirer are both getting together to say...
Let's see if we can really bury this little girl.
Well, no, here's what they say. They say that they know that Mary-Kate Olsen is addicted to coke, that it's not an eating disorder.
Mm.
And they're so sure that she's addicted to coke that they're running these stories, and they even told the Olsen twins and their management, thinking if it's not true, they're going to sue us.
Right.
Well, they're not suing them, so now...
So
that's the story.
That's what she's in rehab for.
That's the story, that she's in rehab for coke. Anybody else think that those girls... I mean, I know that they were cute, I guess, when they were little kids on Full House.
Mm-hmm.
Don't they have, like, horse faces?
I don't think they're that good looking.
The Olsen girl?
And their movie career, you know, I mean, when you break in, you better have at least some box office. And wasn't that movie an unmitigated disaster?
New York Minute?
New York Minute, that's how long it lasted.
Right.
I know some fellas in the station who enjoyed it.
Really?
Some of the young lads.
The young lads who find the 18-year-old Olsen twins attractive?
Yes. A lot of the guys wearing the black T-shirts with the skulls on around
here. Did J-Dubs go to see it?
Now, I'm not going to mention J-Dubs by
name. Did J-Dubs go to see the Olsen twins?
Mike, I'm not going to mention. I don't know that it's J-Dubs for sure.
There's an internet following of men of all ages who were pretty excited about the opening and the fact that the Olsen twins were finally turning 18. This is what I read.
I don't think they're that hot.
No. Mike, this is good news for you.
Oh, that always scares
me. No, it is good news for you.
Okay.
Because it's something that will upset Buzz.
All right. Oh.
Think of all the impressions that you do.
Yes.
What's the one that's gotten on Buzz's nerves the most?
Like, I know I don't have to hesitate. Yeah. Fran Drescher.
Right.
Do it for a second. I'll tell you why.
Oh, hi, Buzz.
Hi, Fran.
Oh, all right. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Did you know that? Did you know that the Lifetime Channel runs reruns of The Nanny?
The Nanny.
No.
Oh, are you kidding me? That's great.
You know that today we got a press release
about The Nanny
on October 11th.
Yeah.
It's The Nanny reunion.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Don.
A nosh.
All right.
A nosh to remember.
A nosh to remember.
They are going to tape this. We're at Fran Drescher's Malibu Estate.
Of course.
Okay, hold on.
She still looks pretty hot on the... Is it Old Navy that she does the commercials for?
Yeah, that's the thing about Fran Drescher. Yeah, easy on the eyes, but very hard on the ears.
I mean, Fran Drescher still looks hot.
She's like I used to think about Kathy Lee Gifford.
Mm-hmm.
She'd be great.
I got a story about Kathy Lee.
She'd be great if he would just duct tape her mouth.
Yeah. Kathy Lee Gifford, again, I think this is the only way... She can get noticed now all over Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
She's on, I don't even know what the station is because it's not PTL, but she was on with one of those preachers today where they sit on the set.
Is it like EWTN or something like that?
Yes, and he's got like the black curly hair and he's got a big face. He's real Southern and she's on there singing. And then she's selling her CD and her book.
Mm.
And she's talking to the guy, and she goes, well, he blesses us with his wishes each and every day.
Yeah.
And they all applaud her.
Sure.
And I'm like, she's really... I think that's the only way she gets on TV nowadays.
On vacation, I don't remember what day it was. It was one of the many days when I was barricading myself in a room, drinking alone. And I turned on the cable system, Channel 24, which was the religious channel, EWTN.
It's EWTN.
They had kids playing a game show, I am not kidding, called Who Wants to Be a Saint?
Oh, okay.
And it was done with the same lights and a kid, all kids, and the kids like going, all right, for 25 points. He was a gigantic sinner. Jesus did pardon his sins, but after he had killed over 2,500 and... You know, who is... Paul the Apostle? Oh! No! And the name of the game was Who Wants to Be a Saint?
Who Wants to Be a Saint? But there she was, hawking a book and hawking a CD and doing some live performing for her.
Oh.
And I think that's what she's... I mean, really, I mean, she always was... She did kind of the God Squad thing, but I think that's all she's doing now.
Yeah.
Also, I got to move faster this week. Get your phone calls in here today. Germans are mobilizing again.
What?
Hi, this is Wolfgang Juretta
from
Germany.
Now,
never forget.
Listen to this from Germany.
Don and Mike Show.
Thank you. Military is spread too thinly, Don.
Thank you, Wolfram. Here's news out of the fatherland, Mike. The Germans are spawning a generation of superkrauts for war in 2025.
Oh, dear.
There's a member of German parliament named Johann Singhammer.
I'm Johann Singhammer.
Now, over the weekend, this guy gets on German TV, national TV, and urges his countrymen to have more sex and breed more children to boost birth rates. And also, he's very concerned that the rest of the world thinks Germany is a weak nation.
We are weak. We are perceived as weak around the world.
Here are some quotes.
Children are our future. German children need to work more on that. and we need to work harder in bed to make stronger children.
And he also says, now this is no verification on this, said that somewhere in Germany he has discovered a one-of-a-kind toddler with superhuman strength.
Oh,
the kid is a genetic mutation.
A genetic mutation. Boy, someplace in.
The kid is three times bigger than most kids, twice his age, and he has half their body fat. He's a little baby boy. He can hold 7-pound free weights with his arms extended.
I am a toddler. I have incredible strength of all of my classmates.
And now here's what the Germans are saying to make you think that they're okay with this.
Okay.
They say, once we understand the mutation,
once we finish the experiment,
we can teach people how to use this to cure muscular dystrophy.
That's right. When in secret we are plotting an entire race of these people to take over the world.
That's too great. Wow. Those crazy, crazy Germans.
Here we go again.
Talk about the genetics with the Germans.
Who's that guy that played Jesus in The Passion of the Christ? What was that guy?
I forgot what his name is. Jim something.
Yeah, hold on. I got Jim Cavavel.
Something like that.
Carey. Anyway, he was in Mexico recently.
Jay Buttock.
He was in Mexico. And it's funny because they all think he's Jesus.
Oh, really?
And like, he doesn't play on it. He's upset that people are approaching him.
I've heard him interviewed. He's upset about everything.
That he's Jesus. All right, and you know, Spider-Man kicked ass this weekend. Mm-hmm. Fahrenheit 9/11 did real good.
One question about Spider-Man real quick. How does Kirsten look in it?
Mm.
Hot?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of her. Is she hotter than she? I mean, mm-hmm. It's tough to improve on that that rain scene.
Mm-hmm. She sure is pretty.
How did the aunt look?
Aunt May?
Yes.
Oh, hot, Rob.
I thought so.
Absolutely
God.
Hot.
I've missed your asexuality, Rob.
Phone scan time right now. Call us. We're running out of time here. You know.
I disagree.
First day back, we always run late. 877-365-3636. Phone scan lies straight ahead. You want to feel good, though?
Yeah.
You want to feel good?
You're going to leave us with a feel good?
I got two feel goods for you.
Excellent.
I got two feel goods. First one is from Vancouver, British Columbia.
Ah, our Canadian neighbors.
Two strippers named Andrea and Shyla. They're on trial because there was another exotic dancer that was performing with them over the weekend.
Right.
And they didn't like the fact that she was hogging all of the customers and was getting all of the attention.
Sure. And the tips, probably.
So they broke a wine glass and punctured her breast implant.
Ow.
On stage.
Ow. Hey, that's a feel good.
But wait, there's more. Oops, hold on. God, is that what you held out?
Six.
Yeah. Indicating hit number six. Oh, there you go. Okay. All right, one more feel good. Even better than a stripper getting her fake boob pushed open with a broken
glass. Well, you got to kind of rip her chest open to do that.
Okay, wow. In Lancaster, Texas, this is near Dallas, there are firefighters that are sitting around cooking potatoes for lunch, and the call comes in. There's an accident. A bad, bad accident.
Now, why were they cooking potatoes?
Well, they were hungry.
Potatoes, among other things.
Oh, okay.
They rushed. They were cooking, actually, potatoes, hot dogs, hamburgers, salad.
You know me, how I like the details.
They were making a standard fireman dinner.
Mm-hmm. Having a potato supper.
And when they, imagine their surprise, Mike, when they left to go handle this fire.
Oh, no.
And, of course, they left the potatoes, you know, still simmering.
And they got the firehouse on fire?
When they returned from the other place, they found out that their firehouse had burned down and sustained $125,000 in damage.
There's the feel good for you.
There you go.
Yeah,
so,
it is.
You know, I didn't know which was better. If it was the fire guys that left and then the place burned down, or if it was the stripper getting mad and breaking the bottle and then breaking her boob open.
Thanks for not making us choose.
So there you go. Well, Mike, that's a separate bit. Then that would be choose your news.
Jerry time.
Thank you, Jerry.
Okay, we'll be right back with a little mini phone scan. Call us. For the phone scam, which is next. That's button 3. Here's button number 4. Thank you.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Tony Perkins has gone coast to coast to California's capital, Sacramento. Hi, Tony.
Good morning, Chief. Good morning, everybody. We got a crowd of people here. I don't know if they're here for Good Morning America, for Railfare 99, or the nationally syndicated Don and Mike radio shows in town today. These folks are excited.
The Don and Mike Show.
The cure for pronated foot. The Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, yeah. Phone scan time at 877-365-3636. Hello?
Lala. Hello.
Lala. Here she is, everybody.
Lala.
My wife, the snob.
Just sitting at a cafe in Georgetown listening to classical music, having a little salad.
Of course you are. All right, baby. Gosh, what was I going to tell you? I guess, you know, there's no reason for rebuttal with anything that I said today on the show.
Because I didn't hear it, so it would be hard for me to rebut.
That's true, but I'm sure when you hear about it, you will agree that you have nothing that's worth rebuttal. Yeah. I talked about our fight that we had out in the street. I talked about the fight when I called you a snob. And other than that, we talked about taking your mom to the fireworks on the bicycle.
And did you say you retracted the snob thing?
Did I mention that, guys, that I retracted
kind of
that?
Did. I think you sort of wouldn't blame you if you had, though.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, well, consider it officially retracted now.
Because I'm not a snob.
No, you're not a snob. And you're right. They have great sales at Neiman Marcus.
Yeah. All right. I'm spoiled, but I'm not a snob. Right. I don't think snob is thinking that you're better than somebody else.
Hold on. That was the word I was looking for. All right, you are a great caller. Thank you. I must go take all the calls now, but I love you, and thanks for being the first call on the phone scan.
Oh, well, you're welcome, Sugar Bear. Whatever I can do.
All right, bye, darling.
All right, much up. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. That was the word I was looking for, not
spoiled.
Snob.
Spoiled. That's different.
Absolutely.
Just spoiled or spoiled rotten?
Yes, Mike. Hello, Donna Mike Show.
One of those.
All of the above.
Hello.
Hello, you're on the air. Hi.
Hello, this is O.J. McKay. Welcome back, Don Juan and Original Five Flavor, Mike O'Mara.
Yeah, now you're really going into the Scott Shannon file.
Absolutely.
We will be signing on tomorrow in Tampa Bay. Oh, and I've been told the station is no longer WQYK.
Oh.
The station is now WBZZ.
Hey, I like that. The Buzz.
Get it, The Buzz?
Another one for me.
Hello, Don and Mike Show. Hello, Phone Scan.
Buzz gets royalties every time.
You guys are back? This must be for Spider-Man.
What did he say?
What's that, Mumbles?
I didn't get it.
Spider, you didn't see the Spider-Man?
Hold on a second, sir. Your mouth is so full of marbles, it's almost impossible to understand.
I did see Spider-Man. I loved it. Mm-hmm. All I heard you say was, are you guys back? It must be Spider-Man.
You heard correctly.
So that's what I did hear?
Yeah, you heard correctly.
Right. Hi, Don and Mike Show. Hello, Phone Scan.
Yes, hello, guys?
Yes, hi.
Hi, Rabbi here. How are you?
Hey, Rabbi.
Hello,
what's
Rabbi.
Happening?
How are you?
How are you?
Great to hear from you again. How have you been?
Oh, Baruch Hashem, I'm doing very, very well. I'm glad to hear you guys had a good vacation.
Had an excellent vacation. And you, how was your fourth?
It was all right. I got a little bit of food poisoning, but I'm over it, thank God.
What caused it?
I think I corroded my O-ring a bit.
What caused the food poisoning?
Bad steak.
Bad steak.
Mm-hmm. Bad steak.
Was it kosher?
Of course. Right. What kind of a goy do you think I am?
Just a goy. I'm a nice goy.
This is Michael Hoffman, and you're listening to Jew to Jew.
Sorry about that. Yes, Rabbi.
Well, I was just calling. I heard about this disturbing news from Germany, and I was just calling to make a statement on behalf of my people, my peeps, if you will.
Yes, go ahead, Rabbi.
Yeah. Because we just had a story on that the Germans have a new mutated
baby.
Super baby.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
So therefore, on behalf of my people, oh, crap.
The official, it's going to be oi crap.
Hello, Don and Mike Show. Hello.
Don and Mike, just wanted to call you guys and tell you your rule. I listen to you every single drive home. I can't catch the whole show, but it's gold. You guys are great.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Try a little harder, though. We're here every day. You know, except for when we take vacation.
Of course.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Is it me?
that is disqualification.
Yeah, and you'll hang up. You'll listen to Dial Tone and then realize it is.
Hello. Not in my show, it was.
Yes, it was.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, you're on the air.
I sat around with bated breath through Best Of in just my briefs. And I still have... Where are the Jerry tapes, man?
The Jerry tapes.
Joe tapes, too.
You know, actually, didn't we have... Rob, didn't you
We wrapped up Jerry. Yeah.
Yeah, we're done with Jerry and Joe and...
Hold on, are we done? Or are you still saving them?
I still have it, but be advised, sir, that you'll be waiting on new Jerry tapes in about 8 weeks.
Oh, and listen, speaking of Jerry, don't forget that little adorable kid, that Maddie kid, died.
Yes.
Oh. So you know that if possible, Jerry will stuff him and bring him on the set this year.
Oh, God. Oh, wow. Jerry.
Jerry, Maddie's over here if you need him.
Hasn't Jerry lost a lot of weight, so we're not going to get the same puffy Jerry that we had last year?
There was always hope, Mike. There's always hope he can balloon back up again.
I might look in if he's, shrunken his pumpkin-sized head.
I hear he has.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
Don and Mike, East Coast Bob. How you guys doing?
Hey, Bob. Goes Bob. What's happening? Hey, that's for you.
Hey, yesterday was the one-year anniversary of the Michael Savage phone call, and no TV reporters and no threatening phone calls from the Savage fans.
All right, outstanding. I'm glad you lived down that day of infamy.
Yeah, that was great. Hey, I'm still looking for those Lisa Joyner nude pictures on my website. So.
Are there?
I heard rumors.
He's looking.
There's this girl I watch on KCBS in Los Angeles, the weather girl. Oh, is she so sweet to look at. Oh, and I love to see some naked
pictures.
She
is a hottie.
All right, thank you.
She used to work with Jillian Barbary. Did you know that? On the Fox show.
And Jillian Barbary just got fired.
Yes. Right? Yep.
Jillian Barbary got fired from the syndicated version of Good Day Live, but not the one that airs just in Los Angeles.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Thanks, Bob. Oh, is he going?
I had already hung up
good,
on him.
Good old scary East Coast Bob.
Hello, Todd and Mike show. Hello.
Hi, guys. Blind Glenn here from Vegas.
Hey, everybody's checking in.
Blind Glenn, thank you for identifying yourself.
How are you, Glenn?
Hey, Mike, you be proud of me, buddy.
What's that, buddy?
Because I went to my niece's wedding in Tampa Bay over the last week.
Yeah?
I had 18 vodkas on the rocks.
Wow, 18.
Man, oh man, you fall down if you drink that much.
Man, I couldn't see straight.
Man, you must have been blind drunk.
I was blind drunk.
Hey, Blind Glenn.
Yes, sir.
Sorry about Ray Charles. Hi, Don and Mike show. Hello.
And we haven't even mentioned Brando.
Hi, guys.
But he wasn't blind.
No.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi there, you're on the air.
Hi. Hey, Mike.
Hi.
Is this Gladys Kravitz?
No.
I just thought we were getting all these regular callers that it might be. Yes, what can I do for you, ma'am?
I just wanted to say, you know how you're having your issues with your Red Sox?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, guess I'm a Mariners fan, and I think I have more issues than you do at this point.
No way.
I don't think so.
Look at the history.
I don't think so.
Yeah, well, the Mariners ain't doing crap.
Yeah, but the Mariners, technically the Mariners have been around for a half an hour compared to the Red Sox.
No, 15 minutes.
All right, whatever.
And the way they're playing, 5.
Darling, yeah. Darling, where are you calling from? Are you calling from the West?
I'm calling from Spokane, Washington.
From Spokane. So what time is it there? 3:14? 3:15.
Yeah, like that.
Darling, you should not be thinking about a man's topic like baseball. You should be thinking about, what are you going to be making your man for dinner tonight?
That's a fine question, and I will put it in the
My
question
form. My man works at Costco, so he brings it home.
Oh, really? Like prepared foods?
Leftovers?
No.
You
know what? No matter how bad the Mariners play, ma'am, fall back on being a lovely, classy lady.
Yeah. I was in Costco yesterday, and maybe you could bring home some of that Stag's Leap chili.
Some of what?
I think that's what it's called. Is there such a thing? I think it's called Stag's Leap chili.
Stag's Leap, a division of Kirkland.
Is it really?
It gotta be.
Yeah.
Gotta be.
Stag's Leap chili. Hey, it was nasty, but they were giving it away for free.
Sure. Listen, darling, I hate taking Mike's side on anything, especially something Red Sox oriented.
Right.
But you got no room complaining about the Mariners compared to the Red Sox.
Well, I love you guys. I'm sorry, my bad.
That's right.
Well, you're right about that.
Yeah, they're talking about a trade, and I hope they don't get that guy John Olerud. The guy that doesn't look like an athlete, you know, he's supposed to be a good hitter, but that's you know what? That's who they'll get.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello,
guten Tag, guys.
Guten Tag.
Hey, Robbie. I just got one thing to say. Deutschland über alles.
Thank Christ, that's the one thing
you
have to say.
What disturbs me is when your fans that call in like that, when they just they throw that out.
Hey, yeah. Robbie. Yeah.
There's nothing comedic about
that. Hey, Robbie, Deutschland over.
Mike, because that's they're all in
it's
the club.
It's Germany overall, and they're saying, right. Hey, bye, Rob.
Can't they just say that at the meetings?
Hello. Leave it to the meeting.
Yeah. Every Don small group needs a leader.
Hello.
Hello, radio friends.
That's what he said too, Rob.
Yeah, right.
Hello.
I'm looking for your.
Robert sure is strong.
You're looking for what?
Each of your current weights, please.
Oh, don't do that.
I don't mind. I weigh about 220. Oh. Hey, 220.
I'm about 210.
Hey, I don't have to tell the truth.
I gained a lot of weight on my vacation.
Why do you care? Let me ask you, why you care?
Oh, just all these images of you guys on the beach and talking about being fat.
Hey, dude, you know, no, I'm not going to go down this road. Never. No. I don't care. If you want to think I look like Louis Anderson, go ahead.
I'm fat on my diet. I am fat. I'm fat again, and I want to lose weight.
Better fat and handsome than thin and ugly.
There you go.
I'm fat, but I'm not as fat as I used to be.
I'm not as fat as I used to be either, but I'm fat again, and I want to lose weight. I'm back on the stick again.
Hello, Don and Mike.
The ice cream stick.
Hello. Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, how you doing?
We're doing very well, thanks.
Welcome back. Did you guys actually hear any of your best of?
Yeah, everyone.
The sound effects they use to bleep out the word that sounds like, I can't remember the guy's name, well, used to make the music.
Listen, here's the thing with the best of. The FCC has changed so much now that...
I know, I feel your pain.
We want to run a lot of the stuff that we used to be able to run, but we have to beep out a lot of it. Actually, Rob brought in some stuff that was almost 20 years old. Did you know that Rob had, like, some WAVA tapes that he brought in?
And we played them on the air?
Stuff that hasn't aired since 1988.
Against my better wishes, they did air. And
I enjoyed that. I heard that part.
And they're still deemed, what's the term that the FCC uses?
Indecent.
Indecent, yes. Yeah.
Well, what's indecent?
How were they, Rob?
I think they're very funny. You had Frank Murphy out to the house for Trivial Pursuit.
I heard
Hello.
That.
Hello. Don and Mike's show. Hello.
Memory.
Yeah.
Hello. All right, I'll try that one. Don and Mike's show. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, you're on the air.
Yes, it's good to have you guys back.
Thanks, great to be back.
Yeah, I was noting during your best of the FCC stuff, and I would just like to say I'm calling from Kansas. And that we have a Senator Brown back who sponsors some of the legislation.
All right.
I would say that, we're not necessarily a hotbed of...
Hey, dude. Save it for Howard's show.
Yeah, okay? That's Howard's guy.
Save it for Howard's show. We're doing the show that we're doing. You're liking it. We're liking it. Let's just move past it.
Well, we should still get out and vote.
Well, no, that I agree.
That's a good message.
No, I agree everybody should get out and vote, you know, for whoever you want to vote for.
Well, I'm going to vote for who the New York Post said. I'm going to vote for Carrie Ann Gephardt.
And Don and I both got up early this morning and went to the New York Post to see that it was Gephardt. And I thought Gephardt, he wasn't my first choice. I was kind of bummed out. I was really bummed out. And they blew it.
They blew it.
And you know there is big trouble when they do that.
Yeah.
Because they went all the way with that.
The funny, hold on, you're going to get a prize. The funniest thing I saw today was... Will Ferrell's on the Today Show.
Right.
And he's dressed up like Anchorman.
Uh-huh.
So he's doing like...
Ron Burgundy.
A skit outside with Katie Couric, who doesn't want to play along.
Right.
And at one point he says, "Hey, Katie, I know that you pride yourself on being a journalist." And he holds up the New York Post and he says, "But have you missed this story? Carrie names Gephardt." He said, "Now this is a piece of journalism."
That's like falling right into his lap, that bit.
Yeah. Wow. He was so gay. And she just... did not get it.
No.
Did not get it. 40K. You know what Katie needs. I know it.
But you know what? There might be the outside shot that she just doesn't like Will Ferrell.
Mike, who doesn't like Will Ferrell?
I don't.
Hey, and you, my friend, what is your name?
My name is Frank.
Where are you from, Frank?
I'm from Wichita.
All right, Frank, last caller on the phone, scan.
In a world where owning a radio was strictly forbidden, one man found a way to bring good news to his people.
Buzz.
He made it up.
You know, we didn't have time for a phone. I apologize. The whole thing got away from me today. We'll be better tomorrow. You've got the complete second season of 6 Feet Under on DVD.
Awesome.
This box set from HBO. All 13 episodes of the show now in a 5-disc box set from HBO. And you've got the exclusive Don and Mike logo sleeve of Pro V1 golf balls, courtesy of Golfdom. Live the game. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
That's in Wichita on KFH FM and AM. Thank you. And now, Buzz, Yes. With the news and comments. Buzz, what is our lead story tonight?
Today, this time, someone was not beheaded.
Oh, well, that's good.
Yeah. Stay tuned for news and comments coming up on the Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike Show. Yeah, we're back. Ready to rock. That was very
professional.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
The Don and Mike Show.
Noted chubby chasers, Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Yeah, baby.
For Buzz's News Now, brought to you by Smoke Break. Smokers break the nasty habit without gaining weight. Smoke Break, revolutionary tablet for smokers. Get it now at fine retailers. And here is Guy Birdley. Hi, Buzz.
Hi, Don and Mike. An American Marine held hostage in Iraq was rumored to have been beheaded, but the rumor was false. The hostage has been released alive with his head still attached. Born in Lebanon, Corporal Wasif Ali Hassan has been missing since June 20th. Now the corporal's brother says he's gotten reliable word his brother is alive, well, and free.
Would anybody else, and I'm glad for it, would anybody else feel a little better if the guy's name was Joe Smith?
I think so. And I think it's interesting when you hear the stories about this, mm-hmm. that his brother, who does not live in the United States.
Right, he lives in Lebanon.
He lives in Lebanon, mm-hmm. and he's getting word through some sort of signal. You know, what the hell's going on? I mean, I'm happy that he's an American citizen and he's been released.
Right.
God knows we don't need any more murders over there, but I'd like to know what the circumstances
are. Well, the group holding the corporal alternated between saying the hostage had or had not been beheaded. They say now that they freed him after he promised not to return to the U.S. military. But one report today says some children in Iraq are staging fake beheadings now as part of their outdoor play. The New York Post greeted the day.
Those crazy kids.
As Don and Mike mentioned earlier, and they greeted the day this morning. Sorry about that. Back to the station. They greeted the day this morning, the New York Post did, with a blazing headline that Democratic presidential candidate John Kerry had chosen Dick Gephardt to be his running mate, but that was wrong. Kerry has, in fact, chosen former presidential candidate John Edwards to be his number two man.
I think we should point out the editorial slant of that newspaper is decidedly to the right, and I think that they were eager because they perhaps wanted Dick Gephardt to be his running mate.
Now, John Edwards is younger than Kerry and has some of the fire in his belly that Kerry seems to lack, so Edwards is the man who will be facing Dick Cheney in the upcoming vice presidential debate.
And you know what I think is jive about politics that I heard today that Cheney calls this guy,
right.
You know, saying like, hey, welcome to the race. I'm the vice president.
Is that your Dick Cheney impression?
How you doing? I'm effing Dick Cheney. Because Dick Cheney throws the F-bomb around.
Yes, he does.
Welcome to the effing race. Yeah. My guy might be retarded, but you're going down. Don't F with me. I'm Dick Cheney.
Edwards is also a senator.
Excuse me, Joe, but I just want to say, we keep that through the election cycle.
Yes, we do.
You know, really? Absolutely.
Yeah.
You have a new one. You're Dick Cheney.
Where's the Nimrod?
I'm right here, boss.
What the hell are you doing? Mountain biking. Did you fall off the bike again?
Stayed on it at the Secret Service Training Center.
It's hard.
Real exciting.
Edwards is also
a... Is that a Pop-Tart in your locker? Is that a jelly donut in your locker? President Bush.
Is chow allowed in the mess, President Bush? Are you allowed to eat jelly donuts?
I love that
because
movie.
Because you are a disgusting fat body.
Edwards is also a senator from North Carolina, and although he only won one primary as a presidential hopeful, he had strong support on the Internet, which in theory translates into young voters. Now, as for Republican Senator John McCain, who many said would make a dream ticket running mate for Kerry, he's come out solidly now behind President Bush. And the Bush campaign says it hopes to get that endorsement on TV in a new commercial this week.
Oh, I saw the commercial already.
Oh, the Republicans are worried about this guy, John Edwards. They were ready to go with this thing immediately.
It's a lot of McCain hugging Bush.
Right.
It's a lot of McCain saying Bush is a good guy.
But the thing to point out is the tape that they use. And I just, you know, maybe it's because I went to see the Michael Moore movie and I watched everything with just a different angle. I really pay attention to stuff a lot more now. Is it in their commercial? Is it an endorsement speech? Technically, it's not. I mean, he's come out and said that he supports the president for his reelection.
He says nice things.
But what he did, he says nice things at a campaign rally where he's introducing him. I mean, that's what it was.
Well, the ad is called First Choice, a reference to the Kerry McCain ticket so many had dreamed of. As for Kerry's second choice, John Edwards, the Bush campaign calls him an unaccomplished liberal and a friend to personal injury trial lawyers.
What I like about all of this is, and it's the same with Republicans as Democrats, if the Democrats had been in charge here, and it was the Republicans, It works the same way every time.
Oh, yeah.
In the beginning part, they eat each other. Mm-hmm. You know, not literally, but they, mm-hmm. you know, they're fighting and they, and eventually whoever the guy is that came closest gets the job. Well, I was watching Fox News Channel today, and of course with their slant, they were saying, now isn't it amazing? But just 4 months ago, Kerry was saying that Edwards didn't know what he was doing, and now all of a sudden, he's the best thing since sliced bread. They all do that.
That always happens.
They all do it.
I mean, the guys were in a race against each other.
And mm-hmm. the other thing, I just have to mention politics-wise, we were on vacation for 2 weeks.
Right.
I read Clinton's book.
Uh-huh.
It was that thing, I'm going to the bookstore with my wife, and I'm looking at, there's like an Elmore Leonard book, there's a Stephen King book.
Yeah, you love those.
And then I keep saying, how you doing? Just mm-hmm. the picture of him. And I thought, what the hell? I'll buy this.
You waited book. Through that 600 plus pages?
935 pages. And I will tell you, there are about 12 pages mm-hmm. devoted to Monica.
Right.
No good stuff.
Mm.
The only stuff that really has to do with that is he does indicate he had to sleep on the couch.
The couch, yes, he did.
For an awful long time. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that I found interesting was, remember when Clinton was on 60 Minutes and they said to him, why'd you do it?
Because he can.
He said, because I can. Right. And at the time, I think even I had said, well, at least he's being honest.
He was being honest. He said it's the worst, morally defensible reason in the world mm-hmm. to say you can, but that's what the reason was.
However, if you read the book My Life by Bill Clinton, when he's talking about when the impeachment stuff was going on, mm-hmm. Newt Gingrich, who was leading a lot of this with, mm-hmm. you know, his Pact with America, Clinton spends about 5 pages cutting down Newt Gingrich because they asked Newt Gingrich, why are you doing this to the president? And his answer was, because we can.
Right.
So even, you know, and come on, you know, I'm on Clinton's side,
yeah.
but I'm reading it going, wait, hold on. It's okay when you say it,
right.
but it's not okay when Newt Gingrich says it.
Yeah, exactly.
But either way, he is still just the goddamn slickest, isn't he? I mean, I'm reading the book, and I don't even like reading political books like
right.
this, but everything he's writing is about, you know, Mother said this, and Roger said this, and Hillary did this.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking at the picture, and I'm no homo, if I look at the pictures going, you know, damn, he's got some charisma.
He does.
He's a good-looking man.
My favorite part is when he said he had to be woken up and fed a cherry pie.
That's Elvis, Rob.
What's that?
That's Elvis.
Oh. Vice President Dick Cheney.
What? One sidebar about Rob's kids.
Yeah. Right?
One night we went out to Secrets. We got a babysitter.
Right.
To come watch Robert and Julia. Robert was no problem because he's almost two and they put him in his place and he went to bed. Do you know that of her own choice, and I saw it, no prodding from anybody, Rob's got about 20 DVDs there. Do you know what one Julia picked out to watch by herself with a babysitter?
Which one?
Wait, let me see if I can guess. I'm trying to think now. Casino?
Elvis.
Elvis.
And it was...
Sure.
Was
Elvis,
it?
That's the way it is. It was 1970 Vegas movie.
She loves Elvis. Yeah.
And I said to her the next morning, I said, good morning, Julie. She said, hi, Uncle. I said, what'd you watch last night? She said, Elvis.
Mm-hmm.
Her choice.
Elvis.
Her choice.
Well, you know, the brainwashing is taking hold, Rob. That's perfect.
Vice President Dick Cheney has fired, without profanity, we presume, his doctor of the last 9 years.
You're fired!
Cheney, who had a heart attack 4 years ago, dismissed the doc when he found out the doctor had abused narcotics at some point. All this according
That's
to
the doctor that said to him, you're fine. You're perfectly healthy.
The New Yorker,
how's my pacemaker?
Go ahead, eat the jambalaya.
The New Yorker magazine reports this. The doctor had already been fired from George Washington University Medical Center a month ago for the same reason. The magazine says the drugs included Xanax, codeine, and Ambien. The White House has no comment other than to say Cheney is looked after by a team of White House physicians.
And that's when they made the announcement of his new replacement doctor, Dr. Joseph Ardinger.
Joe.
And that's the first mention of Joe on the show. How was the break, Joe?
Rob told me that last week... Uh-huh. When Joe, you know, I asked Joe to come on during the best of.
Right.
And, like, a couple times during the show.
I heard it. I heard it a few times.
To say that he was Joe and what
right.
he was doing. What was his message to his girlfriend?
Love you, Tracy, baby.
I was driving back on Tuesday. I was coming back from Atlantic City, and I heard that greeting.
When I mm-hmm. turned it on one time, I heard Joe come out of a stop set with the music bed, and here was the story. I was in Target today, and there was a kid just punching himself in the eyeball. And I thought, this is really funny, and I laughed, and nobody else laughed. Well, it's me, your host, Joe Arden.
It's a Joe Relatable.
And now we're ready for the best of Don and Mike.
Joe's thoughts.
Yeah.
Well, nobody's perfect. Take Spider-Man's dad, for instance. He robbed a bank once. Spider-Man 2 was the number one movie over the Independence Day weekend with a take now of like 180 million.
We don't know who Spider-Man's father is. He was raised by his Uncle Ben.
I'm referring, of course, to movie star Tobey Maguire, who plays Spider-Man in the movie.
Be specific, please.
I was going to get to that, but you're right. Life was not always so cushy for the star, Tobey Maguire, or his family. In harder times, his dad failed to put on a mask before robbing a bank in broad daylight. So naturally, he got caught and went to prison for 2 years, but that was years ago. Toby's dad has since admitted that he did a stupid thing, and Toby has reportedly forgiven him for that. Now, were it not for Spider-Man, the number one movie might have been this week, Fahrenheit 9/11. It, number two, made over $60 million. Even in limited release, it raked in another $21 million over the weekend. It's now the money-makingest documentary of all time. Director Michael Moore's last documentary, Bowling for Columbine, won an Oscar. All that being said, a Midwestern movie theater chain has banned the movie from its screens, accusing the movie of inciting terrorists.
Yeah.
God.
Are you kidding me?
Fridley Theaters of Iowa and Nebraska says it doesn't play political propaganda films from either the right or the left. But beyond that, the company says this movie, quote, emboldens the terrorists.
A quick break when we come back. Buzz, what is next?
More on Fahrenheit 9/11.
Okay, more Michael Moore. We'll be right back.
This
redundant
is the Don and Mike Show.
More.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
Charmingly ghetto. The Don and Mike Show.
And heard in great radio stations like these. Rochester, New York, WHTK. Reno, KBZZ. How about this one? Portland, Oregon. KSLM. Palm Springs, California, WGAM. And starting tomorrow at Tampa Bay on WBZZ. All right.
The empire is expanding.
And we got more coming soon. Here now is Buzz.
Donna Mike.
You got to be home by 7 o'clock. You got 6 minutes. 8 minutes. And that's something you say in the morning anyway.
Yeah,
right?
It is, unless you got the night shift.
And if you're listening to us right now in California, you got to be somewhere by 4 o'clock. You got 7 minutes.
Of course, in Dallas, they could appreciate that.
In Dallas, we're in the middle of the night. You got to be somewhere at 1 a.m. You got 7 minutes to get there.
You got 8 minutes to deliver the paper.
There you go.
Yeah.
Hi, Buzz.
Hi, Donna Mike. The Associated Press has talked with a number of voters who've seen Fahrenheit 9/11. Quoting one, I come from a Republican family, but I'm still figuring out stuff. Whether you agree with it or not, the movie will definitely make you think, and thinking's good for everyone. AP also talked with a number of political science professors about the film, who were divided over whether the movie's increasing America's weariness of the war or whether that weariness is making the movie more popular.
I wonder what Stan Lee thinks about it.
We'll find out, I guess, when you talk to him this week.
That's Spider-Man, man.
Yeah, that's right.
Jerry Todd.
Thank you, Jerry Todd.
Either way, the experts say that nothing like this has ever happened before. Last week, for the first time, Americans said the war is a mistake. By a 2-to-1 margin, Americans said the transfer of power is not a sign of success because it was on time, but a sign of failure because Iraq's still unstable. Now, as the Canadian soldiers head home from Iraq, the owner of a famous U.S. whorehouse has again stepped forward. Dennis Hoff, who owns the Moonlight Bunny Ranch in Carson City, Nevada.
Is that our guy?
That's our guy.
He's offering free visits to the sex palace for the peacekeepers on their way back to Canada. He says it's the least he can do after all the business he's gotten from Canadian hockey players. Hoff's already covered $50,000 worth of visits for U.S. soldiers coming home from Iraq.
Hoff has a good friend in Wendell Hall.
Yes, he does.
Remember that?
Yes.
That's the same guy.
I forgot. Okay.
Hoff's
okay.
He's staged all kinds of fundraisers for charity as well, and spiffed celebrities along the line of Motley Crue's Vince Neil, Hustler's Larry Flint, and former Minnesota Governor Jesse Ventura.
And Don and Mike Show engineer Wendell Hall.
That's right.
Thank you, Mr. Hoff.
Winner!
For the freebie.
Winner!
Now, your annual 4th of July cavalcade of calamity.
Oh, here we go.
In Ohio, two men were killed by shrapnel from a homemade cannon. The men were bikers, not engineers, and the cannon didn't fire. It exploded. They'd been trying to shoot out pieces of bread. In Indiana, a woman lost her toe when she got hit by a firework as her grandson played the bottle rocket version of dodgeball. The 15-year-old grandson was neither an engineer nor a biker, but he is an athlete and an honor student. In Cocoa, Florida, police are still looking for the source of the fireworks mortar that blew a hole in the side of a house. It was apparently fired not by an engineer or an honor student or a biker. It was apparently fired by professionals staging a local fireworks show. And 50 women gathered at a mall in Houston yesterday to breastfeed in public. They called it a nurse in.
Hold on.
Hey, now he's getting excited.
Hold on. Let me pull up a chair.
Yeah, it's your wheelhouse.
Baby.
They were protesting.
That's Don's wheelhouse.
Protesting. That's why the story's here.
Thanks for distancing yourself from that, Mike.
Only on that one.
They were protesting the work of some mall rent-a-cops who asked the woman to either cover herself or move on while breastfeeding her four-month-old son. The security guard said the mall prefers women to do that in the restroom. The mall now says it has no such policy. Yesterday's demonstrators were chanting, "Got milk."
Yeah.
Finally.
I heard where they did that, too.
Where?
Right outside Mrs. Fields.
Handy. Finally, in England, they've taken off the air in England a controversial commercial.
Got wood? Yeah. That's an eye piece agreement.
Of course you would.
In England, they've taken a commercial off the air.
I do.
That's Don.
I do.
Supermarket.
That's right. I'm the one. I'm the one that likes women who are big like that. Thank you. That's me. I'm the perv.
Supermarket commercial's been yanked in England for being too controversial. The ad for Summerfields features a husband complaining about his wife's repetitive menus. Every Friday, he gets faggots. In England, that's a traditional dish of meatballs and gravy, of course.
Oh, but, man. Let's eat faggots tonight.
But people objected because of the word's other meaning. The world seems to be embracing the word queer again, but faggots still touches a nerve.
And this you should not do. You should not say he's an animal. Should not say he's jacko.
One gay group called the word highly derogatory, so viewers will never again hear the harried husband utter the words, "I've nothing against faggots. I just don't fancy them." I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
No!
Oh. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
I said we gotta go. Well, the good news is, it's all downhill from here.
Yeah, it's a total coast.
Yeah. Today was the day.
Yeah, this was the tough one.
Mm-hmm. Today's the good one.
True one.
You know, the first show back from vacation, we're always full of, piss and vinegar and ready to take the world on.
Yeah, you want to tune in again tomorrow as we start our limp to the finish line.
Our thanks to the, we had to bump people today. The guy from the Fox show, the casino.
Don't thank you.
Tomorrow, I'm not really sure. It's the guys from the Amazing Race, or was it,
the winner, maybe?
The winner? I don't know. Who do you got?
Oh, a Charlie interview.
Charlie interview tomorrow. Good. That's it.
Adios.
And we return to Tampa Bay tomorrow.
Hey.
So we'll have some fun there. Great to be back, everybody. Thank you very hard for listening. Good day to you, sir.
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 You.
That's good, faggot.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Yum, yum.
Eat a lot.
Till we meet again. This is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.